Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Command & Conquer 3 Tiberium Wars 1 versus 1 random only July X event, I guess, because we're calling it July X for some reason. But thank you all very much for joining me here this morning. It has been a very long time since I've actually had an opportunity to cast a live stream. That's for a variety of reasons, the most important of which being the fact that it is just so busy IRL right now for me. So I appreciate you guys stopping by here today. It looks like, let's take a quick look and see how many we got here. So we've got 34 of you guys stopping by today this morning already. That's a good showing. But anyways, to jump into today's event, you did notice that there was $150 tagged onto the end of the video name, and that's because we have $150 worth of cash prizes, and I'll explain the breakdown on that and the sponsors a little bit later on. But to run into this tournament for the time being, we do have a standard 1v1 event here today, and it's going to be best of three up until the semifinals, which are going to be best of five, and then the finals and third place rounds will be best of seven series. Now, the starting maps for each of the rounds, the round of 32, if we do have one, will kick off on Pipeline Problems. Round of 16 will start off on Tournament Rift. Round of 8, going to be on Small Town USA. The round of 4 being the semifinal, going to start on Tournament Tower. And then round of 2, which will be the finals and third place rounds, will start on Tournament Dust Bowl. And as for the tournament prize breakdowns, let's take a quick look here. For first place, we are going to have $100 on the line for the first place winner. So it's a cool $100 for anybody that's looking to take a victory here. And we have a few people that are definitely going to be vying for that spot here today. And second place, you will walk away with a modest $30 in your pocket. And then third place, you will also walk away with $20. So a little bit of an incentive to get that third place match played. We'll have to see who ends up coming out victorious. So these prizes are sponsored by Luna Owns and the Command & Conquer 3 Steam Group, so be sure to give them a big shout-out when you guys get an opportunity to. It's pretty fantastic when we have an opportunity to get some money thrown down on these tournaments. $150 is nothing to scoff at either. That's quite a contribution, so thank you very much for that, you guys, and we should have some fun with it today. But anyways, all links referred to during this broadcast are going to be available down in the description of the video, so you can click that Show More button to follow along with our broadcast for today. And furthermore, if you guys enjoy any of the music that you're hearing today, be sure to check out those links down there as well, because there are links to people like Zircon, people like Little V Mills, and people like Spectral Theory, which you'll be hearing throughout the day. All three artists, very, very good, so be sure to give them some love over on their social media and stuff. But anyways, with that said, let's take a look and see if the bracket has been posted. It may not be, as I know we're waiting on a few people here, so it may be a couple minutes of just vamping here until we can get started, but I hope everybody is doing well here today. I guess since I have an opportunity to kind of give a quick synopsis of what's going on, I will try to break into that now. For those of you guys that do follow the channel, I will be posting brand new videos every Tuesday and Thursday, and by brand new videos, I mean that's going to be single game casts. Occasionally I might toss like a series cast in there if it's from a specific tournament or something like that I maybe missed. I may do that as well. But I will be scaling back my tournament coverage. I know, I hate to say that, you guys, and you can unsubscribe if you don't like it. I'm sorry. Don't shoot the messenger. There's a variety of reasons why I need to do this, but the most important of which being my mental health. I mean, there was a stage there for a time where we were doing tournaments, I think every 2 weeks, and that was like eating up the majority of my weekend as far as like an entire day being thrown to either Kane's Wrath or Tiberium Wars. So I'm going to be scaling that back for personal reasons, you know, both to save myself some time, and then also for a number of other factors. I'm just dealing with a lot of stress from work and stuff like that. But again, I don't need to get into that with you guys. You know, you all have your own lives. You all have your own stresses. But this is what I need to do in order to keep myself healthy and keep myself entertained and interested in the game. So that's what we're going to do. Hopefully it doesn't cause any of you guys to stray away. But anyways, we'll be having some fun here today since we do have an opportunity to do a cast. And I guess with that said, there is a good opportunity that if I'm not able to attend events live, that what I'll end up doing is casting semifinals and finals from those tournaments as far as like series go, so that way there's still some coverage of the event rather than just not showing anything from it. You know, that would be unfortunate. So I think that's probably the way I'll go about it, because then I'm able to do it kind of in my own time, you know, when I'm in a good mindset, and able to get that stuff taken care of. But yeah, I guess with that said, let's take a quick break here while we wait for the brackets to be posted. I don't really have too much more to vamp on for the time being. I was hoping that the brackets would be posted now as we're heading about 10 minutes after 9. But anyways, I will be here in the chat, so if you guys want to hang out for a little bit, we can do that. And then once the brackets are posted, we will jump straight into that and we'll try to get into our first game. So anyways, thank you all once again for joining me. It looks like we're up to about 42 people. We should be underway momentarily, so be sure to stick around.
I'm gonna make it. We'll be right back.
All right, everybody, thank you very much for waiting so patiently here. Just to fill you guys in so that way you're kind of in the know as if you're sitting here waiting for this event to start. We are, in fact, waiting for Bike Rush Owens to show back up. I understand he was kind of away and needed a few minutes to get back. I guess we're waiting a couple more minutes for him to get back, as I believe everybody is kind of interested in seeing him actually play in this event. I agree. I think it would be great to have him. I think it would make everything a little bit more competitive. But all the same, that is why we are waiting at the moment, just trying to give a few extra minutes so we can get another very good player here. But it looks like the brackets should be posted shortly here. Actually, they may have just been posted. Let me see. Actually, no. Brackets have been posted. All right. I stand corrected. So let's jump into it. It looks like we're going without Bike Rush. Bummer for him. Okay, so taking a look at the brackets, it looks like we have Shocktopus, which is going to be Shock Treatment, playing up against Petrod, I think it is. I'm not even going to try to pronounce that name. Pterodactylus? I think that's how you say that. I'm pretty sure I've got that right. Anyways, down below that, we have Luviscott getting a free win, playing under that training account Smurf, and Bert, a.k.a. Mushroom Owns, getting a free win out of the round of 16. Going to be facing off against Phantom 9399 in the round of 8. And they should be facing off. I would estimate that Bert will be walking away with the win there. Bert, actually a pretty good player. So we'll have to see if Phantom can maybe take a game or two off of him. I'm not holding my breath. No offense, Phantom. I love you, buddy. But I think you're a little bit out of your league in that situation. Anyways, down below that, we have Maze facing off against Plokita Wolf. And I also predict a very sad day for Plokita Wolf. But all the same, good luck to you, buddy. I know you're in the stream, so good luck to you. He's going to be facing off against Maze. We have Washing Machine, a.k.a. Goofing, another good player, getting a free win out of the round of 16. And then we have down below that Taipei 252, a.k.a. Big Mole, getting a free win out of the round of 16. Going to be facing off against Drimmer. Drimmer, I believe it is, as he did replace few numbers for letters there, I believe, but it's going to be Big Mool versus Drimmer in the round of 8 to finish us off. So not a huge tournament. Again, Tib Wars tends to be a little bit lower in terms of player counts. We are working to kind of revamp that back up. And again, getting a nice $150 from Luna Owns in the Command & Conquer 3 Steam group definitely helps that out. So thank you again to the sponsors of today's event. And with that said, I guess we're going to jump into our first game. We won't waste too much more time here vamping, and we'll be jumping into our first match, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to our very first game of our Best of 3 Round of 16 series? I think it's a Round of 16 series. And that brings us to the map Pipeline Problems. And spawning up on the top side of the map as the pink Skryn, we have Shock Treatment. Or Shocktopus, I may call him either name, we'll have to see. And then down to the bottom side of the map, his opponent for today as the orange Skryn, we have Pterodactylus. Pterodactylus, I'm going to get this name wrong. I think I'm just going to call him Taro. Pterodactyl, I don't know. Petro. I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to end up calling him. I've never cast this guy before. I'm not sure who it is. I'm not terribly familiar with the Tib Wars player base and or game, so forgive me if I make mistakes throughout the day, but we won't worry about it too much for right now. Looks like it is going to be an Explorer opener here for Pterodactylus. And he should be looking to maybe drop a Warp Sphere. Wow, I can speak. Warp Sphere up on the top side of the map. Maybe look to put some early pressure on since he does have access to that blue Tiberium right at the beginning of the game. Meanwhile, I don't think Shock Treatment knows that this is coming. He's scouting on the far right side of the map. Seems to be, ooh, he's actually going to get himself an Assimilator kill here if he's paying attention, and he definitely is. And there we go, an Assimilator going down there for Pterodactylus, and Shock Treatment going to be feeling good about that. He's just going to keep this buzzer up here behind the spike, so that way anytime another Assimilator is sent up there. Whoa! Okay. I was going to say that outpost is unpacking super, super late. But it looks like it is unpacking now. It looks like a couple of secret tanks. Whoa! How did he spot this? Did he guess? Shock Treatment, how in the world did you know it was there? He must have seen it pop up on the radar. But anyways, he's going to get the tier 2 down before the outpost goes down. So looks like Shock Treatment is not going to be able to prevent this from happening. However, he is going to be able to keep units on the front lines to be able to keep them from massing up. Actually, a pretty good lightning spike placement there, as it's going to kind of block off this pathway here. He could have actually got, a little bit further into this, but I think they could still squeeze around all the same. Pterodactylus, I would imagine he's going to be struggling for eco right now. This is kind of a weird build. He went for a foundry and a drone platform build here, but went for a very aggressive push. He's not going to be able to put any pressure here, so Shock Treatment is going to shut this down hardcore right now. Looks like tier 2 is going to be going down. So Pterodactylus, maybe not the most experienced player, or maybe just making a little bit of a mistake with that build. But it's not going to be working out for him. He's going to be forced to drop his Warp Sphere, first Warp Sphere for him, back on his original main. And he's going to have a lot of Seeker Tanks coming in to harass his field right now, so I don't know if he's going to be able to hold this off. We already saw the Lightning Spike come down. And meanwhile, Shock Treatment is just ecoing like crazy, already up to tier 3, already has tripods coming out. Meanwhile, we have two Warp Spheres being dropped on the front lines to try desperately to hold on to this. Tier 2 does come down now. However, these units are just going to be killed off instantly the second they come out. Buzzerhide being dropped there, that should have been probably a Photon Cannon. Would have been a little bit better in this situation. However, you may not have access to it. I forget if you need a barracks or not to build those. But anyways, it's looking like it's going to be the slow push to victory here for Shock Treatment, as he does have Eco already established on his next expansion. And we do have the repair drones being called in by Shock Treatment as well, just going to be keeping these secret tanks a little bit more healthy as he's continuing to fight on the front lines here. And this is the problem when you're fighting on the front lines like this. The Warp Sphere is giving those free repairs to these units, even though you may have a larger army. The smaller forces with the repairs could end up being more beneficial. But Lightning Spike calling in from Shock Treatment, and he's going to be looking to continue to beat away on this force here. He does want to stay in range of his repair drones, but this is looking pretty bad for Pterodactylus. I don't know what he's going to be able to do here. He's losing a lot of stuff. I mean, he's managing to beat this back somewhat, but he needs to start pumping out some dev tanks. I think that's really the only way that he can cost effectively stop this at this stage. He's actually called in repair drones of his own here. I think that was a little bit unnecessary. If anything, he should have waited and called them in up here. Just give him the advantage as he pushes forward. Now Shock Treatment going to be continuing to win that war of attrition there. Devastator Warship's already coming out here for Shock Treatment. It looks like he's pretty content with just camping this one out. He has an Explorer, or rather an Outpost, all the way down on the bottom side as well. Could be looking to get up an extra Warp Sphere, or actually he's going to be getting up another set of refineries. So a lot of refining here for Shock Treatment. It's going to take a lot for him to throw this game. And knowing Shock Treatment's prowess and being one of the people that we would expect to come home with the victory here in this entire tournament, I would not be shocked to see that. Congo line coming out from the tripods. I like the fact that they're all lined up like that, leaving a nice little pathway behind them. And they're going to be moving in. Honestly, those four tripods could potentially end the game here, as we did see. Looks like the Mastermind did run in here, got a capture on a refinery, or rather an extractor. It looks like he got himself a harvester as well, as I believe that harvester is under Shock Treatment's control. Basefield comes off on the harvesters, and that's going to allow a little bit of time here for these tripods to get into range. And we have more and more of these Devastator Warships being pumped out. We already have shields online for them as well, and the Devastator Warships seem to not even be worried about this Seeker Tank force. They're just going to continue to run forward and look to maybe get into the base here of Pterodactylus. And again, it's looking like it is just going to be a slow push to victory here for Shock Treatment. I'm not quite sure what Pterodactylus could even do at this stage in the game to really outplay. He's still pumping out Seeker Tanks despite having Tier 3, just because he needs units on the field, but they're not going to be able to do anything against these tripods. So again, guys, keep in mind this is a round of 16 series, so this is the way this is kind of intended to go. There is a possibility of upsets, but typically the stronger player comes out victorious in these situations. But anyways, we have packs coming out now for Shock Treatment as well, and it's looking like the remainder of the Seeker Tanks is going to be going down. More Seeker Tanks being rallied to the cause here. It looks like maybe a Mastermind being built here for Pterodactylus. It could help him out a little bit. I don't know how much it's going to really help at this stage, because he's not going to have a whole lot of ability to capture a ton of stuff here. He sells off both of his warp spheres. He must be really strapped for cash. Finally gets out the Mastermind. Not quite sure where it went to. It may have actually been killed off already. Nope, there it is. There's the Mastermind, and it's going to die. Is he going to capture anything with it? Got to capture something with it, buddy. Capture something. Nope, it's going to go down. And I think that's all she wrote here for Pterodactylus. Not looking too good for him. He's going to sell up. GG comes in, and that's going to be it for game number one. Shock Treatment comes through with the victory. So pretty commanding victory there for Shock Treatment, kind of what we were expecting anyways. I'm not terribly familiar with who Pterodactylus is. Looks like he's a fairly newer player. Did have an interesting build at the beginning of the game. I did like it, and actually Shock Treatment didn't seem to see it, or maybe he just wasn't worried about it. So if he would have dropped a warp sphere on that and then base creeped towards Shock Treatment's expansion, he could have put a lot of pressure on. But again, things are easier said from the observer perspective than they are in-game. So good game to these two guys. Shock Treatment going to be walking away with a commanding victory in that game, and we'll be headed into game number two momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number two of our Best of Three Round of 16 series, and that brings us to the map Tournament Coastline. And spawning in the upper left-hand corner, coming off of a commanding victory in the last game, being dealt the pink Skryn, once again, we have Shock Treatment. And then sliding down into the bottom right position, the man that's down 0-1 and is in... Wow, as... I can't speak. Is in match point situation, needs to win this game and the next one in order to stay alive as the orange GDI, we have Pterodactylus. So I think I'm going to stick to my normal intro because that one just didn't work. But anyways, it looks like it is going to be an engineer running up towards the top side of the map for Pterodactylus getting GDI this time around. So we'll have to see if maybe he's got something a little bit more interesting for GDI. But anyways, it is going to be, a walking assimilator here for Shock Treatment going up to the top side of the map. Does he actually have one headed down to the bottom side? It doesn't look like he does, so this is kind of interesting. I don't actually know where people send their normal engineers to on this map. Whether it's, they go for the ones that are on the top side, if they're on the top side, or, vice versa. Anyways, not going to worry about it too much. Looks like just going to be some normal scouting here in the early game. Let's take a quick look and see what we have coming out for early builds. It looks like it is going to be a foundry build here for Shock Treatment. Going to be getting out tons and tons of eco, maybe expecting not to be rushed here by Pterodactylus, and it looks like he is right to assume that. We have two refineries down and three harvesters here for Pterodactylus, and meanwhile we have three refineries and five harvesters already for Shock Treatment. So a lot of eco here. A second foundry? Wow, okay. Super, super eco build here. And we do have a pit bull going to be moving in here for Pterodactylus. Maybe looking to get some eyes on Shock Treatment, see what his base is up to, and he has double foundry. That is not a build I have ever seen. But then again, we don't see Tib Wars very often here on the channel, so going to be seeing some interesting stuff. Again, this is pretty unusual. I think it's because Shock Treatment feels confident in his early game here. He knows that he's not going to be pushed too hard, and feels comfortable just to eco up for the time being. Meanwhile, we have a crane build coming out from Pterodactylus, but is pretty far behind in terms of eco here. We have a Predator tank coming out for him now, so it looks like he's going to stick with 5 and 2 on his main field. 5 harvesters, 2 refineries, that is, for anybody that doesn't know. The Tib Spike down on the bottom side of the map still has not been captured, and I think the assimilator was sniped up here? It must have been, because I don't see it. And we have a Seeker tank force firing on the ground there. Looks like a pit bull just continuing to just get some sporadic damage off on some of these structures. Just getting some vision there. Again, pretty slow early game here, as it looks like Shock Treatment feels comfortable just ecoing and winning that way. However, we'll have to see if Pterodactylus has something a little bit more interesting up his sleeve this time around. Still nothing really tech-wise to speak of here for Pterodactylus. Would have thought with that foundry that he would have, or rather with the crane, he would have been building some more infrastructure behind himself while he was expanding. Doesn't look like that's going to be the case, but going for an aggressive expansion here for Pterodactylus. Meanwhile, Shock Treatment going for the more conventional safe expansion here. And will likely move towards the center of the map here as time goes on. But most likely when he moves to the center of the map, that is going to be for his slow push to victory once again. But we'll have to see. Maybe Pterodactylus has something up his sleeve. I am a little bit concerned about his build for the time being due to the fact that he went for a crane and didn't seem to really be building anything off of it. Actually, that crane is stalled for the time being. Looks like it is building something now, but Shock Treatment, again, not really putting a lot of early pressure on, maybe giving Pterodactylus some breathing room here. I can appreciate that, not rushing somebody every single game when you know you're a bit of a higher skill level. I can appreciate the consideration taken there as somebody who's been rushed almost every game in his career. Anyways, Harvester is going to be getting pressured now by a couple of Seeker tanks. There's really nothing here to actually defend them. We'll more than likely see a couple of those Predator tanks being moving into position to defend it, but nope, they are moving across the map here, and they're going to look to put the pressure on Shock Treatment's expansion, and need to be focusing down the Devourer tanks here in this situation, getting some crushes on this infantry. However, nice building block there, using the portal to actually protect his Devourer tank while it sits on the back lines. However, that Devourer tank should be going down. A couple more shots and that one will go down. Looks like Buzzard just getting in there for some scouting information. Meanwhile, Shock Treatment still pounding away on these harvesters. Looks like there really isn't much to stop them. 4 refineries being dropped on this expansion. Holy cow, that's a lot of refineries. Should be looking to maybe sell one of those off. I don't think he necessarily needs 4. But anyways, Predator tanks have managed to run their way all the way through this base, but unfortunately getting chewed up in the process. And meanwhile, we have more and more of these disintegrators being pumped out to deal with them. And they're just going to eat them up. looks like a devourer tank or two being thrown into the mix there. Just going to be using them to clean these guys up as much as possible. And we also have annihilator tripods out as well. So tier 3 done here for shock treatment. Meanwhile, continuing to have more and more of these predator tanks streaming forward. Putting a little bit of pressure on these harvesters, but it looks like shock treatment doesn't seem to be too worried about it, dropping more extractors on the front lines. Gets a phase field off on a couple of these harvesters. Could have potentially bunched all of his harvesters up and got a phase field on all of them, but I don't think he seems to worry too much about it, and I can understand that. He's got an eco advantage right now. As you can see, he's already completely picked clean his entire next expansion, and the third expansion is already being worked on, or rather, second expansion, third base. And it's going to be a base creep coming in here from shock treatment. It looks like it is going to be a push here coming out from shock treatment with the aid of these tripods moving in. And with the cover of these buildings, they're going to be able to do quite a bit of damage. Storm column just being dropped in there. Going to be able to do a bit of damage to these units, but not a whole lot. It is going to be the tripods that are going to be doing the majority of the DPS here. And they should be able to eat up these predator tanks without too much trouble. I guess around the War Factory, they might be able to hold their own for a little bit, but the tripods are in pretty significant numbers, and then even if those are beaten back, you do still have Devourer tanks on the backside of that. Meanwhile, Devastator Warship's going to be pumped out on the front lines here for shock treatment, so going to be looking to, again, just push his way through the remainder of this base, just brute force it. Doesn't really have to do anything too fancy here. He just has the simple tech advantage and production advantage here, just due to the fact that he had a better build. So, again, I think it's going to be a slow push to victory here for shock treatment. And it's just a matter of seeing how long Pterodactylus can hold on. Looks like he's expanded backwards towards a safer expansion here. Should be able to hold on to that for a little bit, so it looks like he should have some eco. Unfortunately, does lose his MCV there. Either that or sold it off. Whoa, wait a second. Was that an MCV? I don't know if that was actually an MCV. I'm pretty sure it was. But anyways, refinery is now just going to get focused down. There's really nothing to stop this. I don't foresee anything really being built in the near future. Looks like Mastermind comes forward, gets a capture on the construction yard, needs to sell that off. He gets the sell. I think he was maybe looking to drop a structure there before he sold it off, but decided to sell it off. I agree with the decision there, as there is a lot of infantry around. He would have killed that Mastermind after a short period of time, but it looks like the avatars are going to get focused, or rather, tripods will get focused down by this infantry, so actually a decent transition here from Pterodactylus considering the situation. These rocket squads will be able to do a pretty good job against pretty much everything here, except for the fact that they're getting eaten up by the shock troopers and the planetary assault carrier. So again, slow push to victory here for shock treatment. Not a whole lot more to be said, just waiting for Pterodactylus to essentially tap out of this game. He's going to hold on for as long as he can. I can respect that, but I don't really see many paths to victory here for him. He does still have a War Factory, does still have a crane, so his build is not gone. However, if you take a look at the minimap, you can see the base sprawling and the absolutely insane production and eco here coming in from shock treatment. He's actually placed himself three refineries on this expansion as well, so just adding insult to injury here as he continues to push forward, eating up pretty much all of the eco on the map that he can. GG comes in from Pterodactylus, and that's going to be it. Shock treatment walks away with a clean 2-0 victory. So, pretty solid game there from shock treatment. Holy cow, look at that unit production. We gotta take a look at that. Hold up. Look at that unit production. He was just like, alright, eco. Alright, we're just gonna spam units and just win this game. Holy cow, look at that. Alright, that's some production right there. He was probably just gushing cash too, because that's the nice thing about Skryn. You don't have to have any kind of silos or anything like that, so you can eat up as much of that precious Tiberium candy as you want without too much worry about having to produce anything off of it. Meanwhile, you can see the resources graph going very much in favor of shock treatment, and Pterodactylus just not able to hold on. Again, the early game decisions there as far as the build goes didn't really work out for him. And shock treatment just having that sheer game knowledge coming through with a victory. So anyways, not going to spend any more time analyzing that game. Pretty clean 2-0 series there for shock treatment. And that's going to put him into the round of 8. And I think he's going to be facing off against Lubiscott. So hopefully that's going to be the next series that I cast here, as I think that's actually going to be a good series. And with that said, we're going to be taking a short break while we jump into our next series. Hope you guys are all having fun. It looks like we have 87 people watching right now. That's actually pretty fantastic considering it is Tiberium Wars. I know a lot of you Kane's Wrath guys out there get a little upset when we see some Tib Wars action, but I think it's going to be fun all the same. But anyways, going to take a short break while we jump into the next series, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number one of our best of three round of eight series. Or rather, God, what is it? I think it's round of eight. Sorry, gonna check this real quick. Yes, it is round of eight series. Best of three round of eight series, and that brings us to the map tournament Rift. And spawning over on the far left side, going for a lot of assimilators early game as the Cyan Skryn, we have Lubascott. And then sliding over to the far right-hand side, spawning as the pink screen for the third time in a row, we have Shock Treatment. So it is going to be Shock Treatment again here in this game. And again, I wanted to jump into this series because I think it is going to actually be a pretty good series. I know both of these guys, I would give the leg up to Shock Treatment. I think anybody would. But, actually, Shock Treatment. Oh, okay, he had a couple of buzzers there. It looked like only one. He managed to stack them up. Lubascott going for an aggressive outpost expansion here on this this expansion. But I guess what I was trying to get at is that Shock Treatment, I think, would be anybody's favorite to potentially win this tournament. Again, Bike Rush Owens, Maze, people like that would definitely be options to stop him. But anyways, a couple of assimilators here from Lubascott potentially could go down here. This is actually kind of scary. It looks like a couple of buzzers managed to sneak into the backside for Shock Treatment. Or rather, for Lubascott trying to clean stuff up. But I think Lubascott's going to be losing some assimilators here. Looks like one assimilator could be going down, but Lubascott going to wait this one out. This is kind of interesting. But anyways, we'll check in on that in a second. Wait. Does Shock Treatment see it? He does. He's going to see it. Oh my god, he's not going to see it! Shock Treatment missed opportunity there, and he's going to lose his Tib Spike for that. He could definitely rally down another assimilator to go and capture that, but he's going to lose that assimilator. Or rather, he's going to lose that Tib Spike. So Tib Spike advantage has been neutralized, and the eco should be even here. It looks like the outpost has been sold off here for Lubascott, but a couple of secret tanks are going to be looking to put some pressure on the tier 2 of Lubascott. Meanwhile, we have Devourer tanks coming out of the front lines here for Lubascott. Going to try to hold the line against a secret tank spam. And this is a bit scary here. The Devourer tanks are quite strong, but they need to shoot. They're not shooting. Okay, here we go. Looks like they're going to try to hold the line. I don't think Lubascott's really going to be able to hold on to this. I think this was a smart move here from Shock Treatment to start spamming out secret tanks, realizing that the numbers advantage would just absolutely win out in this situation. It looks like Warp Sphere being forced to be sold off there due to the fact that there was an assimilator walking up for the capture. And Lubascott already calling the GG, and that's going to be it. Early game pressure just too much for him, and that build was stopped dead in its tracks. So a very, very fast game number one there for Lubascott and Shock Treatment. Shock Treatment going to be coming out victorious there. Well, wait, do I have this backwards? No, okay. All right, I thought I had it backwards there for a second because the little things overlapped with one another. But no, it will be Shock Treatment coming through victorious and Lubascott calling the GG. Only like less than 3 minutes, 2 minutes and 59 seconds. Just realizing that he didn't have much of a path to victory against a player like that. When he's down that much. So I don't blame him for calling the GG early. It's a bit strange, but all the same, that's going to be sending us to game number two. So that's going to be coming up momentarily, everybody. So be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number two of our best of three round of eight series, and that brings us to the map tournament Dust Bowl. And spawning on the top side of the map, the man that hasn't dropped a game and has been given Skryn every single game as the pink Skryn, we have Shock Treatment. And it looks like a little bit of lag here. And then sliding down to the bottom side of the map as the red GDI, we have Lubascott. So not sure what's generating that lag. it is too laggy, I may actually leave to let these guys finish out this series. It would be unfortunate, but let's hope that that this lag clears itself up, because we don't want to interrupt these guys' games at all. Anyways, shock treatment going to be dealt Skryn for the fourth time in a row. That's just statistically unlikely, considering there are three factions. It's a 33% chance. Wow, there is a lot of lag. All right, if these guys ask me to leave, I will leave. We'll defer to them. Not sure if this is just commonplace between these guys, if maybe one of them has a bad connection. But anyways, won't worry about it too much. If they don't say anything, I'm not going to say anything. And it's just going to be some early buzzers out to try to deal with this Rifleman squad. Should be able to get the kill on that Rifleman squad, no problem. Assimilator's moving down. What is this lag? I've never seen this before. Normally I don't comment on it, but it's pretty significant here. It's a good solid couple of seconds here every time. You can see these things are frozen in time. I'm not quite sure what's generating this lag, but I very well may leave just to ensure that it's not me. Alright, if it keeps doing it, I think I'm going to step out. Yeah, I'm going to back out. Sorry, guys. Sorry about that, guys. I'll let them finish up their series. Hopefully the lag stops after I leave. I mean, it wouldn't be good if I'm the one that's causing the lag, but... we're just going to remove one potential variable from that equation to see if they can get stuff situated on their end and maybe finish the series out. But anyways, I'm not going to worry about it too much. Apologies for having to leave that series mid-game, but... We jump into our next one. Anyways, I think I'll use this opportunity to show you guys the bracket, see where we're at. We'll give this thing an update and send it full screen. Here we go. Okay, so let's take a look at the bracket and see how things have shaken out so far today. So we did see Shock Treatment taking a 2-0 victory over Pterodactylus, and he's moving on to play against Training Account, aka Luviscott, in which case Shock Treatment is already up 1-0 in that best of three series. We did just exit game number two, where it was getting a bit laggy. I just wanted to ensure that those guys could potentially play that game out if the lag did stop. Down below that, we saw Bert, aka Mushroom Owns, taking a 2-0 over Phantom, and he's going to be moving on to play against whoever comes out victorious between a Shock Treatment and Luviscott. Down below that, we have Maze taking a 2-0 victory over Plokide Wolf, and a subsequent 2-0 victory over Washing Machine, aka Goofing. So Maze looking to be in pretty good shape right now. He's already moved himself into the semifinals. Meanwhile, looks like Big Mule and Drimmer still underway, potentially. Not quite sure. That series must be going to three games because it's been going on for a while now. I would imagine those results would be posted. Anyways, we won't worry about it too much. It looks like we're headed nearly into the semifinals here. We just have two series from the quarterfinals that need to be finished up in order to get our last semifinalist, and then we'll be even headed into the finals after that. But yeah, that's going to be the bracket rundown. Again, pretty short bracket. That's kind of what we were expecting, but it makes it for a nice short and sweet event, which is going to be a lot of fun anyways. And again, there is $150 worth of prizes on the line, so $100 going to the winner, whoever comes out on top, and then $30 and $20 to the second and third place players respectively. So that's going to be our bracket rundown. I'm going to check back in the lobby and see what is going on and see if there's any update on what happened with that series. But anyways, thank you all very much for joining us here today. It looks like we got up to almost 100 people. We're at about 96. So call your grandma or somebody, get them online so we can get over 100 today. But no, I'm just joking. But anyways, hopefully we'll get another game here for you guys shortly. If nothing else, I'll get you information about what happened between Shock Treatment and Luviscott. With that said, going to take a short break and we'll be right back. Okay, it looks like Lubiscott is back in the lobby here. He's saying that the game was frozen, and he said that when he left that I was already gone. So, again, I'm not sure if it was me or what have you. I think I may let these guys play their last game out just to be sure that there's not a rogue variable there, that being me, potentially causing any more lag so we can get that series finished up. But, again, not going to worry about it too much. These guys may replay, or they may be all done. I'm not quite sure how that's going to end up playing out. But we'll know shortly. I'll let you guys know once I hear from the tournament officials what is going down there. Let's see what this series is. Looks like that's Maze. So I may actually jump into that series. Let's take a look at the bracket and see if his opponent is available. Yeah, so it looks like we can jump into Maze versus Big Mole. I think I'm going to jump in there right now. So actually, that's what we're going to be jumping into next. So it's going to be a semifinal match. It's going to be a best of five series between Maze and Big Mole. And that's coming up momentarily, everybody. So be sure to stick around. Hello everybody and welcome to game number one of our best of five semifinal series, and that brings us to the map Small Town USA. And spawning down in the bottom left position as the blue GDI, we have Maze. And then up in the top right position as the cyan GDI, we have Big Mole, aka Kid Cudi. I believe his name is Big Mole. I didn't actually check him out on Shatterbrick, but you guys can check him out and let me know if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's his name. Anyways, GDI mirror matchup here on Stusa. Both of these guys, realizing that they didn't want to fight this one out, going to be using the garrisons to their advantage. So both going to be getting some secured vision here. And actually, Maze grabbing himself the center, GDI Logistics Center, that nice big tower in the middle of the map. Holy cow, can't speak. And going to be feeling good about getting that map vision early on. So could be seeing some NG APCs as we see two NGs waiting here for Maze. Meanwhile, do we have any NGs out for Big Mole? No NGs. No NGs. And actually, that's an interesting difference between Kane's Wrath and Tib Wars, as we do see Tiberium Silos giving a Rifleman squad or an infantry unit, basic infantry unit for any of the factions. when you sell them off, which is something you don't see in Kane's Wrath. But it looks like a Rifleman squad going to be getting dug in here for Big Mool. That's actually a really good foxhole position as well, because he's going to be able to see where the MCV is if it's looking to expand down in this direction. Otherwise, Maze will have to go and dig it out. So that's a really good foxhole there from Big Mool. Alternatively, he could have gone for this structure here, but it just delays that vision quite a bit, and he wouldn't know until that MCV was already there. So just some nice early vision here, and it looks like it is going to be APC engineers coming in through the middle of the map here for Maze. He's actually going to be sending them to both sides of the base here, forcing Big Mool to kind of split his forces here. Looks like a couple of Predator tanks going to be coming up to the top side, trying to deal with this, trying to protect the MCV. Forces the pack-up of the MCV, realizing that he doesn't want to risk losing that. But meanwhile, that engineer going to be used to grab that Tiberium Spike. And as that Tiberium Spike ticks away with that 25 credits a second, he'll be making up for the 500 bucks that he spent to build that engineer. And Big Mool getting dividends out of this this foxhole here, as he does see the MCV on the move, so he will know exactly where Maze is headed right now. So going to be feeling pretty good about that. It looks like APC engineer did go down here for Maze, but it looks like he managed to force a sell-off of a refinery. So going to be pretty good to get that all the same. Meanwhile, Big Mool going to move out with a couple of Predator tanks through the middle of the map. Those were used to try to defend against those APC engineers, and now they're going to be turned on the base of Maze here. It looks like it is going to be some rocket squads out to try to defend against this. And if they can jump into these garrisonable structures, particularly this one, it will be pretty good, as it will force these Predator tanks to come down here, in which case they're going to have to fight against this garrison as well. So lots and lots of garrisons, and not a lot in the way of garrison clearing ability here from either player. Man, getting lag in this game too. I hope it's not me. I really hope that it's not me that's generating this. Otherwise, I might have to look into my stream settings, though. Nothing has actually changed, unless YouTube changed something. Anyways, not going to talk too much about that. We do see a couple of Predator tanks moving around here. Looks like they're going to get shot up here from Big Mool. Meanwhile, he's putting some pressure on the construction yard. However, he couldn't just drop a barracks and get an engineer out to immediately repair this structure back to the full HP. However, not a whole lot being done here to actually keep this MCV alive. It could potentially be an MCV going down here for Maze. I don't see anything else going on around the map for the time being, so we'll sit here and watch this. It looks like these rocket squads being cleaned up, and it looks like the MCV should be going down here unless the engineer can manage to sneak its way through. It's not even going to be an engineer coming out here for Maze, and he's just managing to keep this alive with just a tiny bit of HP. Finally does go down, should be looking to rebuild that very soon. No, actually has a crane, so smart move from Maze to keep his build alive. Building that crane, he's going to still have some production here. Will delay base defenses though, which will be pretty important here in the near future. He wants to get those up and running. Meanwhile, Big Mool ecoing like crazy, already four refineries on this expansion, is going to be feeling really good about that. Continuing to put pressure on Maze here, and it's looking like Maze may have crumbled in this situation. I don't know what he's really going to be able to do to stop this. He just isn't able to get out any defenses or any units over here to try to stop this. These four Predator tanks really wreaking havoc in this base right now. And actually, we see the construction yard here from Big Mool moving in, and the engineer snipe goes down, and that is going to be it. Wait a second. I had it backwards. I'm an idiot. I'm an idiot. I made a mistake, guys. It was backwards. Maze was, in fact, Cyan. I knew he was Cyan. I don't know why. All right, let's do this real quick. Hold up. All right, we got it right. Maze came out victorious. You guys didn't see the live change. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. I haven't done that in a while. Anyways, moving on. Maze going to be securing himself an early victory. I was going to say, I could have swore Maze would have come out on top in this situation. But anyways, Maze going to walk away with a victory here. He's going to come away with a 4-minute and 48-second victory. Let's take a quick look at the resources. Resources pretty close, except for a little bit in the early game. We did see a little bit of pressure being put on. See, I don't even know who it was anymore. I'm totally lost. All right, we're just going to throw that one into the mulligan category, say that Maze walks away with a victory, wipe our hands clean, and move on to the next one. Anyways, game number two going to be coming up momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number two of our best of five semifinal series, and that brings us to the map Pipeline Problems. And spawning in the top side of the map as the red GDI, we have Big Mool. And the man coming off of a victory, despite what I said in the last game, as the Cyan GDI on the bottom side, we have Maze. Now, for those of you that may have missed last game, if you're watching live, or maybe you just skipped the first game, holy cow. All right, I think I'm just going to turn the stream off. I'm pretty much done. I did screw up the names. I had them backwards. Maze, I hope you're enjoying it as you're watching it after the fact. he was enjoying it in the lobby when I finally told him that I cast it backwards. But anyways, not going to worry about it too much. We'll move on into this game. So Maze is up 1-0. These guys go both getting GDI this time around. So we'll have to see who comes out victorious. Big Mool this time picking Pipeline Problems as the map choice. So it should be interesting. This is an interesting map. You obviously have a lot of Tiberium on the map due to the fact that there is blue Tiberium right at the beginning of the game. So you see typically a little bit stranger builds. And by that I mean it's not just a straight up, you know, you build a bunch of refineries on one field, expand to the next field, build a bunch of refineries. It's usually a little bit more dynamic about that. And that's actually one of the things that I really like about Tib Wars in general as well, is typically the builds are a little bit less linear in that you can do things a little bit more interestingly. I'm pretty sure those are words. But anyways, it's going to be Crane here, I believe, for both Maze and Big Mool. So pretty much mirror builds here for a mirror matchup. Not all that shocking. Nobody actually going for their Tib Spikes just yet. Actually, it looks like an APC engineer going to be coming up here for Big Mool. Going to be looking to get himself his Tib Spike. It looks like he forgot about it, though. And he's going to be sending his engineer in now. Should be able to grab that Tib Spike, no problem. APC engineer going to be getting caught out here by Maze. So going to be able to pick up that APC engineer before it's able to do any damage. And now the base creep is coming in here for Maze. And he should be able to get a nice expansion up and running there. It looks like something was sold off. Not quite sure what it was. May have just been a rifleman squad being killed off by that foxhole. Maze, bottom side, it looked like he was catching something out. But no, it was just infantry standing on Tiberium. And in the meantime, Maze moving around with a single APC and two pit bulls, just as kind of a hit squad for any APC engineers that are running around the map, knowing that he's up against GDI. Tier 3 already done here for Maze, and going for that base creep towards his next expansion. Pretty standard to see base creep like this coming out from Tib Wars, just due to the fact that these refineries give so much build radius, and they're actually quite a bit less expensive. I think they're only 2,000 credits, as opposed to the 3,000 they are in Cain's Wrath. Don't quote me on that, because I don't know numbers very well in this respect, but anyways, won't worry about it too much. I know they're quite a bit less expensive. And yeah, just standard eco coming in here from Maze. Just going to be getting up tons and tons of that eco. APC moving in here from Big Mool. Looks like he's just trying to get some vision. Maybe trying to give the impression that this is an APC engineer, but that one will go down all the same. Not a whole lot going on here between Big Mool and Maze right now. It looks like Tier 3 is done for both players, so it should be interesting to see what they choose to go for off of that. Not sure if there's any upgrades coming down the pipeline for him. Could potentially be railguns early here for Maze and then go into Predator tanks. Yeah, the fact that he's spamming out Predator tanks and there's something researching on this tech lab, I would not be shocked to see railguns done here pretty soon. In the meantime, Juggernaut's going to be coming out here for Big Mool, and Juggernauts are pretty common here on this map. You tend to see a base push clash here in the middle, and those Juggernauts just do so good against that as well. Now it is going to be airfield creep coming in here from Big Mool. Meanwhile, Maze actually has himself an expansion point, so he's going to be getting a refinery down on this expansion, dropping a sonic emitter down as well. A couple of sonic emitters going to immediately take down that juggernaut, but in the meantime, double sonic emitters being dropped here from Big Mool, and he's going to put the pressure back on to Maze and using the airfields to block out these sonic emitters. That's a smart move. Railguns is done, but it looks like Maze's forces have been decimated. In the meantime, it's looking like the sonic emitters just kind of fighting against each other's bases here. And as soon as this base creep is finished, honestly should be looking to eliminate the airfield, I think. That wouldn't take much to kill that off, and it would eliminate any additional sonic emitter drops here. Meanwhile, Harvester's getting shot up there quite a bit. And it looks like the base push has been halted here for both players. So going back into a little bit of a stalemate, but we do have a sonic emitter on the front lines here for Big Mool. Not quite sure why it's not firing. Oh, it's firing on the pit bull. I think it was in minimum range, though, so it wasn't actually shooting at all. That was kind of interesting. Anyway, Sonic Emitter is continuing to fire away on this force, and they're actually going to be really good against these Predator tanks, even with the that railgun upgrade. So a lot of money being invested in that upgrade, but the Sonic Emitters are going to shut it down pretty hard. We'll have to see what the transition is going to be here for both Maze and Big Mole, as they're starting to run out of cash on their main fields. There is a little bit of blue tip here left for Maze that he can potentially scoop up, but the majority of his harvesting has been done, and he's going to be eating up the remainder of his Tiberium field here at his expansion. Meanwhile, Big Mole still has a ton of Tiberium available to him if he's able to get in there and harvest it up. It looks like the majority of his refineries have gone down. He doesn't actually seem to be too interested in rebuilding them either. Actually, no, I say that as he's dropping a refinery on his expansion, but it is going to be additional refineries being dropped. Wouldn't actually mind seeing Orcas or something coming out, just force these guys to go for some kind of anti-air. Actually, okay, Orca's already out on the field for Maze. This is actually, I think, a really nice transition for him. If nothing else, it will force Big Mole to spend on anti-air, and that will allow his otherwise smaller ground force to kind of catch up in numbers here. Meanwhile, absolutely no anti-air defenses here for Big Mole, and he's going to be losing a lot of stuff here. Shockwave Artillery comes down on these Juggernauts. They should be getting focused down here, but unfortunately, the Juggernauts of Maze not in position to actually punish this. This would have been perfect. It would have been a perfect opportunity for those Juggernauts to absolutely pound away on this force, but the Shockwave Artillery locking them down all the same. Now the Juggernauts are going to move into position here. It looks like they're going to get some great shots off. The majority of these Juggernauts here for Big Mole have gone down. I would not be shocked to see Big Mole actually throw in the towel at this stage. He's lost a lot of stuff here and needs to be getting these husks back. He's actually sending out some engineers to try desperately to do that now. Oh my god! Sonic Emitter placement there just kills off three Juggernauts in one shot. These Sonic Emitters absolutely devastating for Big Mole. This is huge! This is huge! This just turned the game around for him. Wow, okay, but he does still have a lot of Orcas to contend with and no anti-air to speak of. And now the Orcas coming in and absolutely wreaking havoc. Nothing to stop them. Going to be looking to kill off these Harvesters. These Harvesters going down is pretty critical because this Eco is really what is going to set Big Mole apart at this stage. But as you can see, the Eco here going to be used on these Orcas. So, man, that was actually really great Sonic Emitter placement there from Big Mole. Manages to kill off almost all of the Juggernauts, but unfortunately not able to clean up the subsequent husks. And that is going to allow Maze to get these Juggernauts back into his hands. And he's going to be feeling pretty good about that. It looks like Big Mole going in once again for another Sonic Emitter drop. Should be able to come in and do quite a bit of damage. Unfortunately, one of these Sonic Emitters not even firing. Should be able to get a good shot off. Brings two of these guys down to about two-thirds of their HP. However, looks like the Orca is going to be rallying to join the fight here. Now they should be looking to kill off the airfields and stop this base push a little bit. Honestly, the Orcas could be cut off into two groups. Four being used for Harvester harassment on the backside of things, and then four being used to continue to punish this front line, but it's looking like it is just going to be a straight-up victory here for Maze, and it looks like Big Mole going to be tapping out the GG coming in, and that is going to be it. Kid Cudi, a.k.a. Big Mole, has been defeated, and Maze is walking away with a 2-0 series so far. It is a best-of-five series, so it does have to be three wins to go into the finals, so that means we are going to get a Game 3, but it's looking very good here for Maze. He has not dropped a game yet today. I think he is, what, 6-0 so far today, if my numbers are right. I think that's true. So could potentially be walking away with another 3-0 here, or we could see Big Mole look to mount an epic comeback. But anyways, we're going to be headed into game number 3. That's going to be coming up momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number 3 of our best of 5 semifinal series, and that brings us to the map term in Arena. And spawning in the upper left-hand corner as the Cyan Skrin, the man that's up to nothing in this best of 5 series, we have Maze. Sliding down to the bottom right position as the Green Skrin, we have Big Mool. So it is do or die here for Big Mool. He needs to come away with a victory here in this game and the two subsequent games after that. That is not easy to say very fast. So a long road to victory here for Big Mool if he is going to be able to mount a comeback. Meanwhile, Maze just needs to clean up one more game. I swear, it's like I'm having a stroke or something. I can't speak. But Maze just needs to walk away with one more victory to come home with the final spot and guarantee himself at least a $30 cash prize. So going to be pretty good. And it's going to be a standard eco build here from Big Mool, actually going for a foundry raid on his main base. Not going for an expansion quickly to the Blue Tiberium, which is kind of interesting. Maze, on the other hand, felt comfortable in doing that. These guys, I don't know if they've figured out what factions each other are. Actually, Big Mool does have a buzzer in the base of Maze, so that means that they both know that they're up against Skrin. Excuse me as I have to clear my throat there. But we do have a number of buzzers moving out here for Maze, likely just going to be getting some garrisons down here and then maybe get some scouting around the backside of Big Mool's base. But nothing too crazy going on here. Actually, Big Mool opting to expand with his drone platform up towards the Blue Tiberium here. An interesting choice. So maybe going to be seeing some early pressure coming out from him. Not quite sure what it's going to be honest. It's not quite sure who's in a better position in that situation. We have double extractor drop on the blue field here from Big Mool. He also has his warp sphere up near the blue tid field as well, so he'll be able to defend that a lot easier if it's harassed. However, that does mean that Maze can potentially punish him in his main. Meanwhile, Buzzer's just getting cleaned up here by Seeker Tank. Seeker Tank's actually not terrible against infantry. They could be worse. But it looks like the Seeker Tanks were rallying off to the blue field, but are now instead heading down south. Looks like they're going to try to deal with the Seeker Tanks. They're coming in to harass his blue field. This is kind of an interesting choice. I'm not sure who ends up coming out in a better position here. I guess Big Mool, he gets his infrastructure a little bit closer to that blue field. He's able to defend it a little bit better. But then again, they're going to eat that blue field up pretty quickly and then not necessarily need to defend it. In which case, having some more infrastructure down in this area, kind of between the two green fields, is maybe a better or safer situation. Not quite sure. We'll have to see. But anyways, Buzzer's continuing to move around for Big Mool. Just going to continue to get some more scouting information, make sure that Maze is not up to anything too crazy here. But Skrin v. Skrin, early game, probably just going to see these guys look to tech up, as we do have Tier 2 for Maze. Likely going to be working on that Tier 3 as he does have the Foundry available. However, we do see a Stasis Chamber come down, so could potentially see a Stasis Shield used in the near future if he's able to find a good opportunity to use it and lock some units down. Not going to really find an opportunity to use that here, at least not in a situation that I would think would be worthwhile. Maybe we'll wait until we see the Tier 3 and then lock down some of those Tier 3 units that are a little bit tougher to catch later on in the game. We'll have to see, but it looks like we have Devourer Tanks coming out now for Maze. We already saw some Devourer Tanks out for Big Mool. So again, we're left with a mirror situation here. Just some slight differences between these guys. It looks like Shock Troopers out for Big Mool as well. No upgrades on those guys just yet, but we may see those come in the near future. However, those Shock Troopers are actually pretty good in their own right without any upgrades. Gravity Stabilizer coming down for Maze. This is pretty interesting. Not sure. It's probably going to be Devastator Warships, I would have to imagine. I can't imagine that he would go into... Oh god, Storm Riders, that's the word I was looking for. Storm Rider production probably wouldn't work out too well for him. The anti-air capabilities here from Big Mool are going to be too significant to contend with, so would imagine those will be Devastator Warships. Anyways, we have some tripods coming out from Big Mool now. Again, these guys just kind of ecoing up at this stage, just trying to mass up, get to a force that they can actually poke in and do some damage. However, both players have the ability to drop a Stasis Shield on their opponent. And looks like it is going to be a bit of a base creep coming in here from Maze. This is kind of interesting. Actually, a base creep coming in from Big Mool as well. Be able to... Wow, actually gets a pretty good Stasis Chamber down... Stasis Shield, rather, down on a couple of Annihilator tripods, as well as Devourer Tank and a few other units. Going to be able to completely annihilate this frontline force and just keep these tripods alive for the time being. However, once these tripods come back online, it's actually probably not going to be a good idea for Big Mool to stick around with those tripods. Shock Troopers, though, could potentially turn the tides here. Need to see these Shock Troopers focusing down the tripods, and it looks like they are going to do that now. Devastator Warship goes down. Big Mool putting a lot of pressure on dropping anti-air defenses on the front lines as well. Going to be trying to contend with these Devastator Warships. Meanwhile, looks like a Gunwalker was sneaking in on the bottom side of things, just trying to get some vision in down there, see what he's up against. Buzzer Swarm Support Power coming in from Maze, cleans up almost all of the Shock Troopers. Actually, I think he got all of them before they went down. So pretty good cleanup there from Maze. Meanwhile, all the Shock Troopers have been cleaned up for both sides. Big Mool, though, has the numbers advantage in terms of tripods, but the reinforcement advantage in favor of Maze, as he can pump these guys out on the front lines. However, these tripods going to be looking to clean each other up here on the front lines. Problem is, if these tripods go down on the front doorstep of Maze, once this fight kind of dies down a little bit, these assimilators could come out and start grabbing these husks away for Maze. Devastator Warships pounding away from both sides, looking kind of messy here, not quite sure who's really getting the upper hand. Because again, Maze actually gets a phase field off on that low health tripod, but now Big Mool definitely looking to be in a commanding position here with those four tripods in pretty good shape. Still managing to push forward, but Stasis Shield finally comes down for Maze, just going to lock these units down, buy himself a little bit of breathing room. But I don't think he's going to be able to mount a defense against this. I think there's just too much stuff here from Big Mool to actually stop. Once that Stasis Shield comes offline, I think it's GG here for Maze. I don't know how he stops this, to be honest. There's just too many Devastator Warships on the top side of things, and just not enough to stop them. Meanwhile, the tripods come back online here for Big Mool, and it looks like it's going to be GG well played coming out from Maze, and Big Mool mounts the comeback here. He's got one victory under his belt, and that brings us to a 2-1 situation. And Big Mool going to walk away with the victory there on Tournament Arena. So, solid game there. Arena obviously being the map choice there for Big Mool, a.k.a. Kid Cudi here in the graphs. And you can see the eco just going in favor of Kid Cudi. So just, I think, some good engagements there from Big Mool there to come through victorious. It really was pretty much a mirror build, minus some small differences early game. You could see Maze actually had a bit of an eco advantage early game because he went for that Explorer setup for the Blue Tiberium as opposed to packing up his drone ship, but fell behind as the game went on. And the base push from Big Mool just too much for Maze to deal with. So that's going to be securing himself a victory, keeping himself alive, and sending us to a Game 4. And Game 4 is going to be coming up momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello everybody, and welcome to game number 4 of our best of 5 semifinal series, and that brings us to the map Tournament Tower. and spawning in the upper left-hand corner as the blue GDI, the man that's coming off of a comeback victory last game and is down 1-2. As the blue GDI, we have Big Mule. And then sliding down into the bottom right position, the man that's at match point, 2-1 series for him right now. As the Cyan GDI, we have Maze. So it is going to be a GDI mirror once again. So we've had four mirror matchups, I think. Is that right? I think every game has been a mirror. Yeah, because we had a GDI mirror, then a Skrin mirror, then a GDI mirror, I think. No, it was two GDI mirrors, and then a Skrin mirror, and then another GDI mirror. I'm pretty sure I've got that right. Anyways, not going to worry about it too much. Another mirror matchup all the same. That's kind of what you get when you got three factions in total. It happens. Kind of interesting to see it happening four times in a series, though. APC Engineer is going to be coming out from both sides, potentially. Nope, it is going to be Pitbulls out to try to deal with this, and the Pitbulls should actually be able to stop these APCs from moving out. Will likely force these guys to redirect, and yeah, Big Mole already sending that APC down to the bottom side of the map. Let me just ensure that I have the names right. Yes, I do. Oh, don't want to make that mistake again. But anyways, APC is still there, but no actual engineer inside of it. However, APC engineer moving around here for Big Mule on the bottom side of things. Does need to be careful, that APC engineer. It's going to get close. I don't think he's going to be able to get the engineer inside, and he is not able to. So Maze is going to be able to keep his Tiberium Spike under his own control there. Meanwhile, I don't think Maze went for any APC engineers of his own, at least not that I saw. They very well could have been killed off while I was busy focusing on something else, but haven't seen anything yet. Looks like it is just Pitbulls out for Maze for the time being. And it is going to settle into a little bit of an eco game here as these guys start to mass up, but I would imagine that somebody's going to look to move their MCV towards the center of the map. I just wanted to make sure they weren't talking about lag. but it's just Maze BMing Big Mule, saying that you're not going to be able to get my Tib Spikes with those NG APCs. But anyways, settling down here for, again, more eco game. It's kind of the way it shakes out. Could potentially see another NG APC, but I don't know. We'll have to see. Let's take a look and see what's going on around the map. These guys seem to be more interested in talking with one another than putting any pressure on. I mean, that's okay. Sometimes the eco game is what you need to do. Rocket Squad's going to be joined into that that garrison here in the center of the map, just giving Maze a little bit more control over this eventual base push between these two guys. Would be interested to see maybe some Juggernauts coming out here in the near future. Need to see Tier 3, though. Looks like they're building up more War Factories just to ensure that they're not being pressured early. A lot of Tier 1 units here coming out from Maze, which makes me believe that he's going to want to put the pressure on here pretty soon. Otherwise, Big Mule is going to get pretty far ahead in terms of tech. He already has Tier 2. Tier 3 is likely on the way. No, it is going to be an airfield, so an airfield drop here from Big Mule. That's going to be the big change. Also dropped some... dropped some mines as well. That's different. But anyways, looks like APC going to get cleaned up here. Big Mule not looking to be in the greatest position. Unfortunately, has to expose the fact that he has an airfield as well, calling in that Orca Strike. And not sure if it's going to be... It is going to be... Okay, so it's going to be Orcas, and it is double airfield as well. Going to be Orcas. Need probably some Hammerheads to try and deal with this infantry, but I don't know if it's going to be... Oh, no, there are no Hammerheads. What am I talking about? Don't mind me, guys. I don't know what I'm talking about. We do have infantry trying to hold the line. I don't think Big Mole's going to be able to hold this, to be honest, unless he's got Tier 3 kicking off somewhere that I don't see. He's going to be able to drop a Sonic Emitter to stop this, but I don't think he will be. And he's going to be running out of eco here pretty soon. May's going to be feeling very good about that. The Orca's going to be coming in, but they need to contend with Rocket Squads, and once Maze realizes it, he's just going to start picking these guys off. Manages to take down one of the Orcas straight away, but takes down two of the Predator tanks for their effort. So, not necessarily the best game here from Big Mule. He's going to call the GG, just didn't have the right setup for this this map, and Maze walks away with a 3-1 victory. So, looked a little bit stale there in the kind of like 2-3 minute mark as they tried to just mass up, and Maze just decided to go for heavy Tier 1 spam, whereas it looked like Big Mule was going for some more, I guess some more tech units, trying to get up into some airfields. That was kind of a risky endeavor anyways on this map, just due to the fact that you're pretty much guaranteed to be pressured if you don't put the pressure on yourself. So not shocking to see Mays walk away with the victory there. Pretty short game, 4 minutes and 56 seconds on the clock. And Mays is going to secure himself a finals berth. So it is going to be Mays against somebody. I'm not quite sure who is on the other side of the bracket at the moment or if the other semifinal has concluded. We will check in on that momentarily. But congratulations to Mays. And Kid Cudi, a.k.a. Big Mool, is going to get an opportunity to take a shot at the $20 cash prize for third place if he sticks around. So hopefully he does. Anyways, that's going to take us into our next series. We'll likely get a quick bracket update. Actually, I might just do that right here while I have you guys. Let's just do this really quickly. All right, so here we go. So let's take a look. It is going to be Shock Treatment versus Burt on the other side of the bracket, as we did see Burt take a 2-0 over Phantom, and it looks like Shock Treatment managed to secure himself a 2-0 over Luviscott. So again, not quite sure what ended up transpiring, whether Shock Treatment and Luviscott managed to play that second game out after we left due to the lag or what have you. But anyways, it is going to be Shock Treatment versus Burt on the other side of the semifinals bracket. That series is likely still underway, or the results just haven't been posted yet. On the other side, Maze did take a 3-1 victory over Big Mool, a.k.a. Kid Cudi, in-game. And yeah, that's going to be sending us off into the finals, or potentially the other side of the semifinals bracket. We'll have to see. But we do know for a fact that Maze is going to be one of our finalists, and I would imagine either Shock Treatment or Burt will be coming through on the other side. Not sure who that's going to be just yet. My money is probably on Shock Treatment, just due to the fact that he is just so good in these events. But we'll have to see. Could be anybody. And that's what we'll be checking in on momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number four of our best of five? Wait, yes, it is best of five. Sorry, I had to think through that one as I jumped into this lobby pretty quickly. Game number four of our best of five semifinal series, and that brings us to the map tournament, Dust Bowl. And spawning the top side of the map, as the Cyan Nod, we have Bert. And then sliding down to the bottom side, it looks like he's actually going for both of those tip spikes, by the way. Sliding down to the bottom side, as the Pink Nod, we have Shock Treatment. So now, as you guys can see on the scoreboard, it is 2-1 in favor of Shock Treatment right now, so he just needs to pick up this win in order to secure himself a finals berth to go up against Maze. Likewise, Bert needs to mount a comeback here, could potentially look to take back a couple games here. If he's able to take this game, he can definitely get himself a spot. And this is actually kind of interesting. Shadow teams walking by one another, they won't even see each other, so he's going to get the snipe on the engineer on that side. But meanwhile, ooh, snipe on this side as well. So engineers being sniped all around, and it looks like shadow teams from both players just going to be able to get in and shut down those engineers. So neither one of the two tip spikes have been captured just yet, and both players keeping around their hand of Nod. As you can see, they are likely waiting for an opportunity to send out some engineers. However, it is a bit dangerous here, as that engineer does get sniped, but that shadow team almost gets killed off completely. But one member of the squad is left alive. Meanwhile, Shock Treatment still running around with two full HP squads there. He's likely going to move in, look to go for maybe a bombing run on one of these buildings. Meanwhile, Bert has managed to secure himself the Tib Spike on the left-hand side of the map, so Tib Spike advantage going over to him. And Shock Treatment is down a couple of engineers here, so he's not going to be feeling too good about that. Actually, I don't even know if he sent an engineer out initially. But anyways, looks like Shadow Team's going to be moving in here. Unfortunately, going to be getting spotted here by the attack bike. And now Shredder Turret being dropped as well. They immediately take off and start flying, and that bike is going to give chase. They do want to land so that that bike isn't doing too much damage to them, because when they're flying around as flying units, they take a bit more rocket damage because they're treated as, I believe, aircraft in the game logic, but we won't worry about it too much. Still nobody capturing that right side tip spike. Meanwhile, these shadow teams getting shot up here. And, actually, I was going to say Bert maybe just looking to go for the fire and forget situation there. But really nice pathing here from Shock Treatment to keep this alive and just keep this bike buggy chasing him around. But that final member of that shadow team will go down. In the meantime, let's take a look and see how these builds are panning out. It looks like we do have a War Factory down here for Shock Treatment. He's already packed up and gone for the expand. So no base creep out from him. He's going to instead pack up and go for the expansion. That's most likely due to the fact that he did lose a couple of engineers. We'll likely see Bert actually go for a bit of a base creep to get over there, as he does have three refineries. No, he's actually packed up his MCV, so that's kind of interesting. Maybe expecting to send his MCV down here eventually, so wants to just cut the distance in half. Unfortunately, a pathing mistake there from that MCV as it walks through the harvester and refinery. Kind of funny. But again, not a whole lot transpiring here in the early game. As we can see, Bert does have pretty good map control. Also has himself a Tiberium Spike advantage over Shock Treatment, so in a pretty good position to potentially get himself a second victory here in this series, which he desperately needs. Meanwhile, Shock Treatment is going to go for some bike buggy here, looking to get back some of that map control. Does not want to be giving that all over to Bert in the meantime. Let's go and see what's going on the top side of the map. It looks like we do have a couple of refineries down here to try and absolutely mine out this field. Still no unpack of his MCB. Ooh, Bert, this is a mistake. Needs to get that MCB unpacked, and now he's doing that. But he is going to be quite a bit behind in terms of eco here against Shock Treatment, despite having Tip Spike advantage. And it is going to be Shock Treatment losing a little bit here as he chases down the bikes here of Bert, but no buggies to actually tank the front lines for him. And these bikes, unfortunately, from Bert, shooting up the buggies as opposed to the bikes. So good trading here coming in from Shock Treatment, exactly what we would expect from the expert in Tib Wars. Meanwhile, it looks like the garrison has finally been cleaned up here of Shock Treatment, so Bert going to be continuing to hold on to this map control for the time being. However, the bike buggy here from Shock Treatment is getting to a pretty good mass, so it's going to likely start tipping the scales here, as we did see Bert's bike buggy. That's not an easy one to say. That's starting to get thinned out here by Shock Treatment's good trading capabilities. He also has the numbers advantage for the time being, but that looks like it's going to be evened out by the triple War Factory bike buggy spam. I would imagine that's what this War Factory is going to be used for. Yes, more buggies coming out there. And bike buggy moving in here for Bert. So, again, not shocking on a map like this to see a lot of bike buggy out. Buggy's coming into the front line, is going to be looking to tank for the bikes on the backside. And decent trading, actually, there coming out from Bert. He's going to be feeling okay about that. However, Shock Jimmy does rally the rest of his bike buggy down to the bottom right corner to join that fight. So forces spread all around the map, and this is where things start getting a little bit messy. And Bert doing a nice job of just continuing to put the pressure on, not allow Shock Treatment to get too much breathing room. He's still not been able to send an engineer up to capture that Tiberian spike. So tip spike advantage still going over to Bert, and actually an engineer that was just walking on the left-hand side of the map, not able to get in and steal that Tiberian spike away from Bert. That would have actually been pretty good because even though he wouldn't have got his money immediately back for grabbing that Tiberian spike, it would have eliminated the income advantage here for Bert. Anyways, bike buggy battle going on between Shock Treatment and Bert here, as we can see. It's getting very messy. Not sure who's trading more cost-effectively. However, Shock Treatment is going to be able to get reinforcements here to the front lines a lot faster. Lots and lots of bike buggy. Very messy engagements here, but we can see a lot of bikes going down on the backside of things as Bert is forced to cut and run. But the forces have been thinned out pretty good by both sides. But meanwhile, there are still a lot of bike buggy for both sides as well. And I would imagine that there will be a transition here in the near future, as we do see Tier 2 done now for Bert, but no Tier 3 just yet. Maybe that is what is being built now. Not quite sure. It looks like in the meantime, Shock Treatment has expanded up to his next expansion, not opting to go for much in the way of tech, if anything. No tech yet at all for Shock Treatment. Meanwhile, he has a Hand of Nod as well, so just triple War Factory Bike Buggy coming out for Shock Treatment. You can see it's just in enormous numbers right now, as it is rolling around the middle of the map. In the meantime, it's just going to be continuing to see these crazy trades between the bike buggy. Flame Tank going to be coming in. If it gets in close range here, it can potentially do a lot of splash damage and really change this dynamic of this fight here. As we see Bert, he's got mostly bikes at this stage in the game, not a whole lot of buggies, which means that he's going to be a bit less tanky than this force that Shock Treatment has. Meanwhile, Shock Treatment wants to eliminate this Tiberium spike from Bert, and he's going to be able to do so pretty easily. Has good control here, and he's going to be able to wipe that out. So Tib Spike advantage now over to Shock Treatment, as he does manage to grab his own Tib Spike. However, Bert is going to chase this force down and getting some nice trades on the way out as these forces cut and run from Shock Treatment. However, Shock Treatment, realizing that he has numbers advantage, he's going to come back and look to get back into this fight. However, I think he's taken a really bad engagement here, because it looks like Bert is managing to get some pretty good trades. Actually, no, this force was in fact Shock Treatment. Sometimes those colors blend together a little bit when they're moving around. However, let's see what's going on the right-hand side of things. It looks like maybe it was just a little bit of bike buggy moving around. Whoa, what is this? Something on the map there, not quite sure what that is. Meanwhile, Shock Treatment managing to grab back map control from Bert, and having this second expansion up is really important, as Bert has not been able to do that just yet, as there's a lot of bike buggy threat on the left-hand side of the map as well. Has been able to move his MCB out. Force firing down on the ground there, not quite sure what that's for. Maybe just trying to regroup and grab a new control group on those forces. But anyways, it looks like Tier 2 has been sold off here for Bert, so Tier 3 is up and running. Meanwhile, Shock Treatment, what has he done? He's got two refineries on this expansion, however, still no tech to speak of. Actually does have Tier 2. Ooh, actually we see a flame tank down on the bottom side of the map. Just happened to move down here and see this. And if that operation center goes down, that could actually deny the tech center from Shock Treatment. He's not going to be able to stop this. And that's going to cancel the tech center there from Shock Treatment. So he's going to have a lot of cash to flow out, but that completely resets the tech here for Shock Treatment. That's not good. Not having Tier 3 at this stage in the game is going to be a pretty bad situation. He's going to need to put on a lot of pressure right now. Bert needs to deploy his MCB. He needs to do it now. Otherwise, he's going to lose it almost instantly, and it gets vaporized. Bert's MCB has been destroyed by the bike buggy. A missed opportunity there, most likely trying to deal with his flame tank down on the bottom side of the map, but losing his MCV was a huge mistake. He has Tier 3, but he's lost his build. He has one clicks as well. The one clicks could potentially save him if he's able to get up the cash to actually use them, but that means that there's not going to be any expansion here for Bert, which means that he's sitting on no eco. He's going to be forced to sell up a lot of his infrastructure in order to recycle that. Meanwhile, we did see a Catalyst Missile, that's the word I was looking for. Tiberium Catalyst Missile being called in, going to be dropping down one of the refineries, but Shock Treatment spreading these guys out pretty well. He's going to be able to keep one of his refineries alive. And honestly, it's not going to matter that much. Scorpion Tanks with the Laser Capacitor upgrade. No Dozer Blades yet, though. which is kind of interesting. Normally you would expect Dozer Blades to be the first purchase. However, it looks like they're not going to be. And those laser capacitors are actually quite good, and they're potentially going to be enough to keep Shock Treatment on the ropes for the time being, as he does have tech advantage. So it's going to have to be numbers advantage versus tech advantage here, and we'll have to see who comes out victorious. I'm thinking that without Dozer Blades, it's going to be pretty bad here for Burt as he sends all of these tanks into this force. And now Fnatic's coming out on the front lines as well, and still with no Dozer Blades, that means that these forces are just going to get chewed up almost instantly. And the majority of these Scorpion tanks going down here for Burt, and more coming in and just being thrown away. So Burt in a bad position right now. He's being forced to build units. However, he needs to build another MCV. And GG actually called by Burt, realizing that he doesn't have any way of stopping this, and Shock Treatment comes through with a victory. So pretty solid game there. That clutch flame tank from Burt was actually pretty good. He managed to knock down the tier 2 just before the tier 3 came online. So that means that Shock Treatment wasted a lot of build time that he could have been using his MCV for other things. However, tier 3 would have likely been what he would have been building anyways. So resetting the tech in that situation put him in a good situation, but unfortunately his MCV being out of position without enough support really put him in a bad spot, and then losing it without unpacking even was even worse. It was just the icing on the cake. So Shock Treatment going to walk away with a 3-1 victory in that best of 5 series, and is going to move on to face off against Maze, who also took a 3-1 in his series. So these guys looking to be pretty even going into the finals here, and we'll have to see who comes out on top, and that's going to be coming up momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number one of our Best of 7 final series, and that brings us to the map Tournament Dust Bowl. And spawning on the top side of the map as the pink nod, we have Shock Treatment. And slotting down to the bottom side, the man that switched up his color just for me, just to try to confuse me, as the green screen, we have Maze. So here we go, game number one, Best of 7 series, and it is not going to be a mirror matchup this time around. It's going to be Nod versus Skrin. Should be a good series here. I'm looking forward to it. Maze seemed less than confident, but I have the utmost confidence in him as he places his refinery the wrong way. I take it back, Maze. I take it all back. Oh, maybe this was intentional. Maybe it was intentional to get that extra build radius. We'll have to see. But Maze, realizing that he is Skrin, he's not going to opt to go for anything too crazy, not going to be sending out any assimilators. And Shock Treatment, in the meantime, is going to grab himself a couple of free Tib Spikes, and he's going to feel pretty good about that. He also has some Shadow Teams out on the map, so early pressure definitely favoring Maze, or rather Shock Treatment right now. Just want to make sure I've got this right. Yeah, so Maze is green. All right, so a couple of Shadow Teams coming in here. It looks like Power Plant going to be going down, and it's going to be denying the Buzzer Hive. Buzzer Hive should be killed off here. Those buzzers should just be turned on right now by the Shadow Team. But it doesn't look like they're going to. Looks like they're going to now. There we go. All right, a little late. And Foundry going to be going down as well. Shock Treatment putting a lot of pressure on early here with these Shadow Teams. Maze just doesn't seem to have an answer to it just for the time being. Does have a Seeker Tank and a Gunwalker out to try and find at least one pair of them. Maybe look to stop some of the harassment here, but he does have a couple more to deal with. That's the thing about Shadow Teams and Tib Wars. So very difficult to deal with. And looks like actually one pair of them gets killed off. So obviously not that hard to deal with. And actually, I would think that Skrin is in a particularly good position to stop them. Unfortunately, Power Plant going to be going down there for Maze once again, and Shock Treatment just continuing to try to make these Shadow Teams pay dividends, and one of the squads getting shot up here pretty good. Actually, one of the squads almost completely killed off, tries to building block it so that squad can catch it, but great micro there from Shock Treatment to finally kill that off, but now the Seeker Tank has managed to get vision of these guys, and he's going to continue to give chase. So again, I'm focusing on that because there wasn't a whole lot more going on. However, we do have a Flame Tank out now for Shock Treatment. He does have that early map pressure, excuse me, as he's moving into Tier 2 and could potentially see an early Tier 3 out of him, or going to be looking to maybe go for an expand to his next expansion. I'm not quite sure what he's going to choose to do here. He does have two War Factories as well, so a Flame Tank on the far right side of the map. And it looks like a couple of Seeker Tanks maybe expecting something on the other side of the map here as they're moving around. And they will catch this Flame Tank. So those two Seeker Tanks should be able to deal with this Flame Tank before it's able to do too much. However, he does need to be careful, otherwise the Flame Tank can be microed to kill these Seeker Tanks off. And yeah, the micro coming in here from Maze to try to keep them alive. And the Flame Tank should be going down here. Three Seeker Tanks going to be able to clean that up pretty quickly. Now they're going to head back to the Warp Sphere for repairs. However, another Flame Tank coming right down the middle of the map. Going to be able to clean up an Extractor. However, there is still an Extractor on this field, so I don't think it's going to be all that devastating. However, another Extractor taking down to about two-thirds of its HP. It's pretty good for Shock Treatment. He's going to be feeling good about that. That Flame Tank definitely going to be paying for itself in that situation. Another War Factory being dropped here for Shock Treatment, so it is triple. No, only double War Factory for the time being, as we did see the first War Factory being dropped off pretty far, or maybe another one was sold off, not quite sure. Anyways, it is going to be Scorpion Tanks out straight away for Shock Treatment, not opting to go for Bike Buggy this time around, realizing that he has pretty good map control, but the Seeker Tank's going to be moving around as well. Tier 3 already done here for Maze, so we have that tripod out on the field. Meanwhile, what else are we seeing from Maze? It looks like it is just going to be tripod production here for him. Meanwhile, Shock Treatment just continuing to position around the map with these Scorpion Tanks, and actually keeping a Shadow Team in the middle of the map ungarrisoned, so that way it's kind of a free scout sitting in the middle of the map that will be pretty tough to detect unless the Seeker Tanks do manage to find it. However, a couple of Stealth Tanks out for Shock Treatment as well, maybe looking to go for a push on one side and then counter attack with rather two-pronged attack with the Stealth Tanks on the other side of the map. However, we've got the Scorpion Tanks with Dozer Blades going to be moving in here. Could potentially be looking to clean up some of these Harvesters. Great phase field there from Maze to actually get all of his Harvesters in that situation. So Shock Treatment, realizing that he's forced out the support power, he's going to be feeling okay about that. He's going to choose to cut and run in this situation. I like that choice. However, that means that these stealth tanks could potentially be taking some damage here from these forces as they get back into position. Stealth tanks are moving in here. Again, no Tib Core available because this is, in fact, Tib Wars. And actually, immediately, a Lightning Spike being dropped, or rather, Storm Column, going to kill off one of those stealth tanks, but it's going to force Shock Treatment, or rather, Maze, to chase this around and try to find this guy. I don't know if he can actually see the trail. I don't actually know, because he seems to be chasing it down. Yep, it has been spotted, and that will go down almost instantly. There we go, it gets vaporized. Meanwhile, we do have a couple of avatars out for Shock Treatment, so going to be seeing those guys making their debut for the first time today. Pretty nice to see that. And what do we have going on the other side? It looks like Shock Treatment has both of his upgrades for his Scorpion tanks, laser capacitors and dozer blades done for them. So those Scorpion tanks are going to be just a bit more powerful. Meanwhile, we have a lot of avatars being queued up on the left-hand side of the map. So it looks like a half dozen avatars and a couple of Black Hand squads going to be running around. Likely the Black Hand squads being used to try and deal with any infantry that is going to be sent out from Maze to try to kill this stuff off, either the Shock Troopers or potentially the Disintegrators if they do, in fact, change here in the near future. But anyways, Shadow Team moving in, just likely getting some scouting information, wants to see where the forces of Maze have been sent. Looks like one of the tip spikes has been cleaned up here, and it looks like that was actually cleaned up by Maze. So opting to destroy the tip spike instead of capturing it, that's kind of interesting. Either that or Shock Treatment did something kind of funky, I'm not quite sure. More and more units being spammed out here by Shock Treatment, just continuing to try to reposition around the map to make sure that Maze can't poke in and just annihilate one of his bases here. Meanwhile, Maze, he's going to rally down to the bottom side of the map, or rather the far left side of the map. In the meantime, I think he needs to send his drone ship. Okay, there it is. I was going to say, he didn't lose his drone ship, did he? So his drone ship is already moving up for the expansion here. Going to be looking to get that next expansion online. And it's going to be a battle over the expansions at this stage. And it looks like Shock Treatment going to be playing defense in this situation as we see the Shock Troopers with those upgrades, the Plasma Disc Launchers upgrade, going to be able to clean up a lot of the Venoms there that were being used to try to clean up the infantry. Tib Vapor Bomb? No, it is going to be a Mind Drop, and it's going to be able to put these tripods down to pretty low HP as they're all dropped down pretty heavily. Great Stasis Shield coming in for Maze, going to be able to lock down four of those tripods, or rather four of those avatars, because this is getting to be a bit of a messy fight. As we can see, the tripods are getting mixed in with the avatars here. Should be able to get EMPs on these avatars, and that's why these tripods are just so good. They can walk up and win the 1v1. And GG coming in for Maze, and that's going to be it. Shock Treatment managing to hold the line. Maze, realizing that he doesn't have anything left, is going to call the GG. So actually, I didn't think that was looking too terrible for Maze in that situation, but unfortunately he did spread his tripods out a bit too much, and then Shock Treatment getting a great Mind Drop to bring those guys down to pretty low HP, so that way when the Stasis Shield came offline, the tripods could, or rather the avatars could immediately focus them down. So great play out of both guys. To be honest, it was just that last few seconds of engagement there that kind of dictated which way it went. Also, Shock Treatment getting his second expansion up and running a bit quicker than Maze was, so you would be able to recover even if Maze won that fight. But anyways, not going to harp too much on this game. 8 minutes and 15 seconds on the clock. That's going to be it for game number one. Shock Treatment is up 1-0 in this best of seven series, so it's 1-4. And game number two is coming up momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello everybody and welcome back to game number two of this best of seven final series, and that brings us to the map Pipeline Problems. And spawning on the top side of the map as the orange nod, we have Maze. And sliding down to the bottom side of the map as the pink GDI, we have Shock Treatment. So Shock Treatment coming off of a victory in the last game, going to be looking to secure himself another victory here in this game. However, May is getting map choice this time around, going for pretty much a mirror build here as these guys look to get their refineries in place. And exactly mirror build as we see these guys moving around getting their refineries built and sold off so that way they can get that extra harvester out a little bit quicker. Pretty solid move here from both of these guys. And yeah, I would imagine it should be a pretty good fight here in the middle of the map towards the mid game here as these guys start expanding towards one another. We haven't seen any early game shenanigans just yet, which would normally have already taken place at this time if there was going to be any kind of a crazy rush. So it doesn't look like that's going to be on the cards here. Both of these guys playing it safe. I like the choice. It is going to be an APC engineer move here coming out from Shock Treatment by the looks of it. So a late APC engineer may actually convince Maze that it's not going to be coming. However, Maze, once he realizes that he's up against GDI, he does have to have that in the back of his mind that that's always a threat. So actually, this may be Shock Treatment just being safe and sending this down to grab his own Tiberium Spike. I'd actually like that choice quite a bit. It looks like actually maybe that's what this one is doing. I think the other one may actually be looking to secure Maze's Tip Spike. That would be interesting. It looks like Bike's coming out here for Maze, coming over to the right-hand side of the map, maybe expecting Shock Treatment to send something down the far right side. And he is going to be correct in saying that, as we do have a single Bike and single Buggy catching out an APC here. The APC is focusing down the Buggy, so it's not going to be able to keep that engineer alive for too much longer, as the engineer does go down. So one APC engineer has been knocked out here for Shock Treatment. Meanwhile, he does have his Tib Spike. Let's take a look and see what these builds are looking like for the time being. Tier 2 is done for Maze. Tier 3 just came online as we're speaking. And let's take a look and see what Shock Treatment is up to. He's going for a more aggressive eco expand here, as he does have the refinery out already. And he's going to be getting his next refinery out on top of that, most likely. So Tech going to be a little bit further behind here for Shock Treatment, as Tier 3 is not even really being cooked up at this time. At least, not that I'm seeing, unless that's being built off of the crane. Yeah, the crane's taking a long time to build something, so I imagine that's a Tech center. But the MCB being packed up here for Maze, realizing that he doesn't have his buildings in a good enough position to base creep here. He's going to opt to move the MCB anyways. I like that choice, as it gets the MCB into a better position so that way he can drop some more base defenses. But Tib Wars, you just have so much build radius. It's pretty ridiculous, as I roll the R there for some reason. Anyways, Pitbull's out from Maze, going to be looking to put the pressure on, or rather from Shock Treatment, going to be looking to put the pressure on Maze. This map always throws me off because I don't have a good scoreboard for this. But anyways, it looks like one of the harvesters is going to be going down there, but a lot of Pitbulls being traded out for that. Not sure if that's going to be worth it there for Shock Treatment. However, he does eliminate one of the harvesters, and that's not terrible. It could be worse. He could have gotten away with no harvester kills. In the meantime, Maze has managed to eco up pretty hard. He already has 5 refineries on this expansion. I don't think he necessarily needs 5 refineries, but is maybe looking to use this as build radius at this point, get some more harvesters on the front lines without having to tie up his production queues in the form of his war factories. So, not the worst choice. Infantry going to be coming out here for Shock Treatment. And looks like it's going to be Juggernauts on the back side of things as well. So infantry with Juggernauts is pretty good in this situation. You can just siege, use the infantry to tank the front lines and take out any units that are pushing forward, like Avatars and things like that. Maybe look to take down these Obelisks as well as they're being dropped. But the Obelisks on the front line is going to be putting pressure on these Harvesters here. And it's pressure that can't really be relieved. That one Harvester is one shot away. However, Juggernauts are finally focusing down these structures. Gonna be kind of tense here for a time, as we do see a lot of infantry and a refinery going down there, and a number of harvesters going down as well. Great Tib Catalyst missile there coming in from Maze, and a lot of this infantry is going to get pushed back, as we did see a majority of it going down to that Tib Catalyst missile. But Sonic Emitter on the front lines as well, gonna be able to deal with the Avatars pretty easily. Rocket Squad's doing a nice job, but Black Hand Squad's out from Maze, gonna be able to deal with his infantry pretty handily. As they run forward, going to be looking to focus down this Sonic Emitter. Honestly, I think that's what they would be looking to kill off. However, they could just sit there and tank that Sonic Emitter and kill some more infantry. That wouldn't be a bad idea either. A couple more of those Operation Centers being dropped, so more and more of this Black Hand Squad spam coming out from Maze, looking to deal with all this infantry coming in from Shock Treatment. And it looks like he's going to be able to clean up all of this infantry. However, there are a lot of Juggernauts here sitting on the back lines for Shock Treatment. No EMP out for Maze for the time being. There's no good way of locking those down at the moment. We'll have to see if EMP coils are upgraded in the near future. Maybe see some heroic raider buggies running in there and just EMPing down those juggernauts and then allowing the tripods, or rather, God, I always want to call them tripods, but they're avatars, move in there and kill those guys off. We'll have to see. Sonic emitters versus Obelisk, I would have to say that I would favor the Sonic emitters just due to the splash damage. But we'll have to see. And it looks like the avatars are going to get an opportunity to focus that Sonic emitter down without taking too much damage. Sniper team's being called in as well. Actually, no, they were built. They're not called in because they don't have any veterancy. Black Hand Squad's on the front lines. Is going to be burning down these Sonic emitters. Juggernauts not being building blocked out just well enough, and they are going to go down. Obelisk being dropped on the front lines as well. I'm going to stand corrected. These obelisks are very good, and they do guaranteed damage versus the Sonic emitters, which do splash damage, but it's a little bit more sporadic as to whether or not they hit their targets. Avatars moving into this base. They should be able to clean up all the harvesters. He's continuing to chase the juggernauts away. I like this choice, and just allow these obelisks to do their job on the backside of things. But with the avatars up in the faces of these juggernauts, I think that's going to be GG here for Shock Treatment. Unless he's got something sneaky up his sleeve. I don't see any APC engineers around the side of the map or anything like that. So this may very well be a game going down here for Shock Treatment. He is going to try desperately to hold on, but the GG finally comes in, and that's going to be it for game number two. Shock Treatment has been defeated, and we have a series, folks. It is 1-1. Maze picks up a victory in the end. So pretty solid game there. Honestly, looked like it could have gone either way once we got to that mid-game fight, and Maze just managed to come through with a better unit composition, manages to get a nice Tib Catalyst missile, drops a lot of the eco, and also expanding towards Shock Treatment, getting a couple of obelisks down, knocking out some of those harvesters, and then just continuing to push forward with the avatar advantage over the juggernauts, force them to move back so that way they're not doing any damage, and just allow his base creep to win out. So very solid game there for Maze. Obviously had a game plan for this map and comes through with a victory 7 minutes on the nose. So that's going to be it for game number two. That sends us into game number three, and that's coming up momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello everybody, and welcome to game number three of our best of seven final series, and that brings us to the map Tournament Tower. And spawning in the upper left hand corner as the pink GDI, we have Shock Treatment. And then spawning down in the bottom right position as the purple Skryn, we have Maze. So it is a 1-1 series here. It's anybody's game coming up in game three. We'll have to see who manages to pick up a victory here. It's going to be pretty critical to take this victory. I think this is going to be kind of the morale victory for either side. However, I know Maze is feeling a little bit down in the dirt right now. I'm not quite sure why. He's playing very well in both games, actually. It's been both games have been decided by pretty much one mid-game fight. And actually, unfortunately, a buzzer there being cleaned up by a harvester. Not what you want to see with your scouting units, but anyways, it's looking like it's going to be just scouting all around. Again, nothing crazy coming out from either side. APC engineer out for Shock Treatment, but that has been caught by Maze, and he should be able to clean up this APC. Could see a mine drop out, potentially, from Shock Treatment, but he's not going to even waste his time. He's going to go ahead and deploy force those secret tanks to kill the engineer as well, and they will go ahead and do that. So APC engineer down on the bottom side should be able to grab himself a tip spike away from Maze as well, give himself a two spike advantage over Maze, as Maze will not have a single Tiberium spike to his name after that. And as we do see on the map, it does get captured, but looks like just a rifleman squad getting cleaned up there from Maze. And we're just going to settle in here for the eco game as these guys start to stabilize out. It looks like the barracks is being kept around by shock treatment. Not sure what the plan is just yet, but he has pretty good control over the tip spike game for the time being. Does manage to get his garrison cleaned out here by a buzzer squad from Maze. So most likely Maze is going to be sending out an assimilator to go grab that tip spike back. Does not want to allow that economy advantage going over to shock treatment for too long. That's exactly what's going to happen. We do have another APC engineer on the top side of the map going to be rolling through. Most likely going to be used to try to capture some infrastructure. Nope, it's being rallied back down to the south. Maybe going to look to take that tip spike again, just force Maze to keep recapturing that. We'll have to see. But it looks like Rifleman Squad going to be running in down on the bottom side, trying to get some scouting information, but is going to get cut off there by a seeker tank. Meanwhile, it looks like it is going to be Rocket Squads being pumped out here from shock treatment on the front lines. Going to try to defend against an inevitable push here from Maze. But Maze doesn't seem to be too concerned about being aggressive here in the early game, knowing that Skrin's power is really in their late game. He's going to opt to go for tech. And shock treatment could punish this by going for some tier 1 spam. We have seen him be successful with that in previous games. We'll see if he chooses to do that this time around. It looks like he is going to put some pressure on here. He does have some tier 1 units. Should be looking to maybe push forward now. Maybe respecting the fact that Maze may have some defenses here. Most likely Maze ready to defend his base here in the near future. But doesn't actually have anything built at the time being. Another assimilator being built on the bottom side, as we did see the engineer APCs coming in from shock treatment to capture that again. So just forcing Maze to rebuild assimilators, and actually his forces are completely out of position here. These four seeker tanks really should be in defending his field, but unfortunately there are not going to be any phase field being forced to be used on all of these harvesters. It will keep all five harvesters alive, and also they can stay on the front lines doing what they want to do. Stasis shield comes down, locks down this entire force. Great stasis shield from Maze. And now his tripod is in range, could potentially be looking to just run over this force as it comes back online. Honestly, should be looking to maybe position this tripod back over here, so that way when this shield wears off, these forces have to choose to either push forward or move backwards, and this tripod can just run over the top of them. He is going to try to run in for the crushes now. Should be able to crush the majority of these units. Oh, man! Devastating amounts of crushes there coming in from Maze. But that's kind of what we were expecting anyways. Stasis shield being called in that situation. It's pretty much guaranteed that stuff is going down. A couple forces get away here for shock treatment. He's going to get away with one predator tank. So given the situation, it could have been worse for him, but it couldn't have been much worse, to be honest. But Maze, in the meantime, he does have a couple of Devastator warships out. Not a lot in the way of anti-air defense for shock treatment at the time being. He does have some AA batteries being dropped now, so he should be able to whittle away at these Devastator warships over time. A couple of rocket squads going to be joining that fight as well. And he's just going to be forcing out more of these AA battery drops. And actually, I don't know if he's microed the AA battery to kill that off. No, the rocket squads are going to kill it off. They go elite in the process. In the meantime, it looks like Devastator warship production has been halted here for Maze. We do have a couple of predator tanks down on the bottom side of the map. Maybe looking to clean up this tip spike, just eliminate it. And that way the tip spike advantage stays in favor of shock treatment. We'll have to see what it ends up being. In the meantime, shock treatment content with just camping this one out, as he did have his early forces beaten back by Maze. And yeah, it looks like the predator tanks are going to try to take down the Tiberium spike. However, Maze sending down a shock trooper to try to deal with this. They do have plasma disc launchers, so could be trading out his tib spike for a predator tank. Could be worse. Could just lose that tib spike for free. Actually, it looks like a decent-sized force going to be sent down here. It looks like a number of shock troopers going to be sent in. He should be able to keep his tip spike alive. I think that's going to be enough shock troopers to kill these guys off. Needs to be focus firing these guys down. If he can eliminate one of these predator tanks right now. Ooh, this is going to be close. No, it's not going to be close. The predator tanks do go down, and the remainder come down. Oh, but the orca strike comes in and finishes it off. So a valiant effort there from Maze to try to hold it off. Focus firing could have been a little bit better. Could have potentially kept himself alive a little longer. However, the eco has been more or less cleaned up here on the expansion fields between shock treatment and Maze. However, shock treatment does have a fair bit of tib left to harvest. Has railguns done as well, and is getting out some mammoth tanks. Those mammoth tanks are just so devastating with railguns. as they just dish out so much DPS. It also makes those Predator tanks so much more cost-effective at this stage in the game when there's just no Tib left on the map to grab. Looks like Storm Rider's going to be flying around as well. I think maybe a lone Storm Rider in this situation. It's probably all he needs. It's going to be able to get some scouting information. Going to see exactly what is going on here on the other side. But, ooh, okay. Firehawk's coming in from Shock Treatment. Had no idea those were out. However, they're going to be flying around. Should be looking to kill off a Devastator Warship here. And they are not going to be able to kill that Devastator Warship. That may be his Tib Spike. I don't think he's got any way of stopping this. I think these guys are both going to lose their Tib Spikes. And that last volley. No, he's not going to be able to kill it. Wait, he's turned around. Oh, that's a missed opportunity for Maze. I don't know about the choice there. Is he intending to send him the simulator up to grab that himself? I think that's a missed opportunity. I think, honestly, he would have been better off just killing off that Tib Spike. I think he had enough damage. Even if he loses that Devastator Warship, it wouldn't have been the worst thing in the world. Eliminating that income, especially late game, is so important. Meanwhile, it looks like Harvester's being rallied here for Maze. Going to be grabbing up this Tiberian being left over from the killed off Tib Spike. Ooh! Actually, we did see a wormhole come in. Going to be able to get the capture on the MCV. Whoa, wait a second. What? Holy cow! He teleported the MCV out! Not only did he steal it, but he steals it and walks away with it. What? Holy cow, I was not expecting that. So now Maze has a GDI build as well. Holy crap! That was a steal and a half right there. So that's what that Storm Rider was for, to get some information, scouting information for that wormhole. Oh man, that was pretty big right there, because now, even though Maze doesn't really have the forces to hold off against this, he might. And now with double base defenses here, both GDI and Skryn, this is going to be interesting. He's going to be able to get some GDI infantry out as well. However, Harvester's going down. It's not going to matter all that much right now, just due to the fact that all the harvesting is pretty much done. Firehawk's just absolutely wreaking havoc on the Devastator warships, but now... Oh, it looks like the construction yard has gone back over into the hands of Maze, or rather over into the hands of Shock Treatment. The Prodigy, or the Mastermind, must have got sniped? I'm really confused. Did he deploy that and then... I'm confused by what happened there. Anyways, not going to harp on it for too long. It looks like the forces here from Shock Treatment continuing to push in. However, Maze has a lot of tripods. He is managing to beat back these Mammoth Tanks. That's what needs to be the focus right now. Focus down the Mammoth Tanks. Keep these guys from doing too much damage. He is going to run these tripods in right now. He needs to kill these Mammoth Tanks off, and then the infantry can clean up the rest of these rocket squads. He's not going to be able to get into the range. There are Juggernauts on the backside of things as well. Gets the EMP on one of the Juggernauts, but it's not going to be enough. All of the Mammoth Tanks have been cleaned up. Infantry here from Shock Treatment going to continue to focus down the infantry of Maze. But, man, this is getting confusing. I don't know whose infantry is whose. There's a lot of Rifleman squads coming in from Maze. And, wow, this is getting messy. I'm not sure who's really coming out on top. It looks like the Juggernaut sitting on the back lines for Shock Treatment could potentially be the thing that sways this game in favor of Shock Treatment, as Maze is kind of being denied here on this field. The Firehawk bombing just being continuous as well, just so devastating. It looks like they managed to get a split fire on that double power plant there. But now a couple of Shock Troopers going to be giving chase to these Juggernauts. Could potentially see the sniper teams turn around and focus these guys down, but I think they'll end up dying as well. Trying desperately to kill off these Juggernauts, and he's going to be able to do that. One of the Juggernauts being caught out here. It looks like it was a miss micro. Maybe it's stuck. I'm not quite sure. But honestly, need to see these husks getting cleaned up. Don't want to see those go back into the hands of Shock Treatment. Not at this stage in the game. And he is going to clean them up. There is another husk up here. I don't know if he sees that or if he's too interested in killing it off. But a Harpster being called in here on the front lines to do some damage. And this is looking to be a pretty interesting game, as both of these guys are ending up in a situation with pretty much no eco left. However, there are four Firehawks left here for Shock Treatment, and this could definitely be the thing that tips the scales. Maze gets the sell-off before the refinery is destroyed. However, he has nothing to deal with these Firehawks, and I think that's going to be the death of him. GG coming in from Maze, realizing that he has no way of winning this war of attrition, and that is going to be it. Shock Treatment comes through victorious in game number 3. That was interesting. That was very interesting. I'm confused by what happened with the MCV. I don't know if Shock Treatment packed up his MCV and then sent it through the wormhole himself, but I'm pretty sure Maze had control of that MCB due to the fact that he was using it to produce barracks. So very strange to say the least. Very unconventional, and that's what we expect from Maze. I like it. But anyways, that's going to be it for game number three. Shock Treatment's up 2-1, but it's still anybody's series because it is a four-win series. You have to take away four wins in order to walk away with a victory. So game number four is going to be coming up momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number four of our Best of Seven final series, and that brings us to the map Barstow Badlands. And spawning on the far left side as the yellow Nod, we have Maze. And sliding over to the far right-hand side of Barstow as the pink Skryn, we have Shock Treatment. So Shock Treatment is up 2-1 in this Best of Seven series, could potentially put himself at match point if he picks up a victory here. And I think he'd be feeling good about that. Maze putting a lot of pressure on Shock Treatment, though. He's definitely making Shock work for this. We'll have to see if he can maybe pick up a victory here. Maze getting the map choice this time around. And he's going to opt to go for Barstow Badlands. An interesting map. Definitely an interesting one for Tiberium Wars. There's actually a fair bit of Tib on this map. And it's a very small map, so should be quite interesting. And it's going to be Nod v. Skryn this time around. Not sure who has the implicit advantage on this map, but it looks like Shock Treatment going to be grabbing the Tib Spike advantage all the same early game. And the bridge being focused down here by Maze, I think that was just a misclick. I think he may have just been adding a control group there. He's going to be using this Raider Buggy to get some scouting information. I like the decision here. And in the meantime, Maze going for his expansion. He has two refineries and a war factory, so he should be all set to get his production online. Interesting placement of the MCV here. I don't know if he can actually deploy under the bridge. He must be able to deploy under the bridge because I think that's the only radius that he would be able to build in on this platform. That's kind of interesting. I've never actually seen that before. But then again, we don't see this map all that often. Shock Treatment going for the exact same thing, so maybe this is the thing you do on Barstow. Most of the times I see people sending their MCVs down here, but it looks like these guys have figured something else out. I like this. It's interesting. It looks like a refinery being placed underneath underneath this bridge. So just using up that build radius there wherever they can, and likewise going to be the same exact thing for Shock Treatment. So mirror builds coming out from these guys. However, we do have a number of these Seeker tanks on the top side of the map, going to be contending with a couple of Scorpion tanks. And it's going to be the battle of micro here, as Maze is not able to keep that Scorpion tank alive, and now the numbers advantage definitely going to be favoring Shock Treatment. He could potentially turn the turrets and focus on this Harvester now, as he does have stealth detection. That Harvester is as good as dead. Lightning Spike being called in as well. I think that's a little bit unnecessary. However, there's a War Factory under there as well. GG called already. Maze realizing that he has no way of stopping this, and that's going to be it. Game number four going over to Shock Treatment. I don't even really need to comment too much on the end of this game. I mean, it was just some early game decisions there made the difference between victory and defeat there. Maze maybe throwing in the towel a little bit early, but I understand his thought process there. Once that expansion is kind of shut down, it's pretty much GG. There's no real way of recovering from that, so opting to throw in the towel as opposed to dragging that game out to the inevitable same end, minus some crazy shenanigans. But anyways, under 3 minutes for that game, and that's going to be GG. Shock Treatment's up 3-1 right now, so the scales have very much tipped in his favor. Could potentially see him take a victory here in the next game. We'll have to see game number four? No, game number five coming up momentarily, everybody, so be sure to stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome to game number 5 in this Best of 7 series, and that takes us to the map, Small Town USA. And spawning down in the bottom left position as the Red Nod, we have Maze. And the man that's up 3-1 in this Best of 7 series only needs to take a victory here in this game to secure himself a $100 cash prize. As the Pink Nod, we have Shock Treatment. So Maze really needs to mount a comeback here, as he's lost 2 consecutive games, and that's not exactly what you want to be seeing here in a situation like this. And puts Shock Treatment in match point position, so he only needs to win one of the next potentially 3 games in order to secure himself a finalized victory. So we'll have to see. We will have to see how it plays out. Not looking too good for Maze, though, I will admit that. And Shock Treatment opting to go for the safe Garrison as opposed to going for the further one on this, this side. And likewise, going for the safer one on the top side as well. Meanwhile, Maze going for a fast expand to the top side of the map by the looks of it. Going to be going for some base creep as he did go for a double, or rather a crane build as well. So he's going to be dropping structures like crazy. So no early aggression out from him. And it's going to be a Nod Mirror this time around. We've seen actually a Nod Mirror or two already, so I'm not going to say that it hasn't happened. Lots of scouts to try to prevent these scouts from actually getting to the base of Maze, and likewise, or very likely that Shock Treatment knows that something is up. Either an unconventional build or something more eco-heavy. And it's going to be the eco-heavy this time around. As we see the base creep coming in from Shock Treatment as well, already up to tier 2, could potentially see a flame tank out from him. That wouldn't be a terrible idea, honestly, as there's really nothing out from Maze to actually stop that. I don't think he's actually built a War Factory yet. Nope, double War Factory on the top side of the map. I stand corrected. He hasn't just built one War Factory, he built 2. And we do have Scorpion Tanks moving around on the top side. Going to be looking to defend this expansion here from Shock Treatment, but Shock Treatment not going to be too worried about that. He's going to be expanding down towards the bottom side. In the meantime, it looks like the Black Hand has been sold off. Looks like it was used actually for an air tower. So maybe looking for an opportunity for a mine drop here. That's kind of interesting. I would have expected the Tier 2 to be used for a Tier 3 production. But also going to be using this Black Hand squad to clear out some of these garrisonable structures. They should be able to come in and clear out all of these garrisons without any trouble at all. Maze isn't going to be liking that because he's going to lose control of the center of the map here as far as vision goes. And we do have a buggy into the base of Maze here from Shock Treatment, so he's going to be seeing what he's up against, realizing that there's pretty much nothing there from Maze to actually hold the line. All of the forces from Shock Treatment are going to be coming in. Mine Drop comes in, but there's no harvesters there to actually mine drop. All the harvesters were pulled. Why were all the harvesters pulled? I don't know why all the harvesters were pulled off the line. That's kind of interesting. Maze may be feeling a little bit fatigued, not quite sure, but... Okay, so actually he's got Scorpion Tanks into the base of Shock Treatment, so it's going to be a bit of a base trade here, as it actually looks like Shock Treatment is going to be regrouping and sending all of his Bike Buggy back to defend his base. I don't think this is going to be worthwhile, honestly, because I think Maze wins this even with the Bike Buggy returning back to base. Because he's just going to clean up the Bike Buggy. I mean, if nothing else, it may be Shock Treatment just buying time for his production to get some Scorpion Tanks up. But no, he's actually doing a great job of cleaning up these Scorpion Tanks here from Maze. Maze continuing to stream in more and more of these Scorpion Tanks to reinforce his lines, but Shock Treatment's just done a devastating job of cleaning this stuff up. And I think after cleaning up all the harvesters, Grat's coming in from Maze, and that's going to be it. GG is called, and Shock Treatment walks away with a 4-1 victory. So not quite sure why... Yeah, I don't know. It was an interesting move there for Maze to send all of those Scorpion Tanks up to the top side, but a missed opportunity, I think, by having all those Harvesters pulled off the line. It may have just been a miss micro while he was dealing with the Scorpion Tanks. Didn't realize that his Harvesters were pulled off the line, or I'm not quite sure what it was. Maybe he pulled them off the line to try to hide them. I'm not quite sure what the purpose was, but all the same, that's going to be it. Shock Treatment comes through with a victory, and he's going to walk away with a $100 cash prize. So he's going to be $100 richer today for a few hours of his time. We're at about noontime here on the East Coast, and so we've been running for just, I think, just under 3 hours. As far as the tournament goes, I know the stream's probably been just about 3 hours on the money, actually. But anyways, that's going to be it. Shock Treatment walking away with a $100 cash prize. Maze is going to walk away with a respectable $30 cash prize for second place. And we'll have to check and see if anybody finished up the the third place match. I'll take a quick look at that and see if that was played out. Actually, let me see if I can find it on the bracket here. Looks like the results have not been posted. I will ask in Skype. Alright, so I'll wait to hear back on that. But in the meantime, again, congratulations goes out to Shock Treatment. I'll go ahead and pull this up on the scoreboard so you guys can see it. So it looks like actually the third place match was not played, which is a bit unfortunate. Both players left, missing an opportunity for $20. Yeah, that's a missed opportunity. I mean, for a few minutes of your time, possible $20 cash prize. But anyways, this is the final bracket. You guys can see it up on your screen. That is going to be it for us today. Shock Treatment going to be taking the victory 4-1 over Maze. Maze going to be walking away in second place. Put up an admirable fight in all the series that we saw today, honestly. He actually did a very good job early on in the stages. Actually flawless up until the semifinals, in which case he dropped one game to Big Mool and then secured himself a 3-1 victory. Likewise to Shock Treatment, looking very dominating in this tournament here today, only dropping two games overall, one to Burt and one to Maze. However, honestly, the games between Shock Treatment and Maze, the first three games, I would say, were actually all very close. So it's a bit unfortunate to see Maze being defeated 4-1 in that situation. But all the same, Shock Treatment showing his pure dominance in Tib Wars, the man to beat for sure these days. So very, very good effort from both of these guys. Congratulations to everybody that played. Thank you all for joining me. We've been absolutely killing it in terms of the stats. Let's see. Yeah, our peak concurrent viewers was 130 today, which is absolutely astounding, especially considering it's Tib Wars here today, which is unusual to see that number show up. It's nice to see everybody showing up for this. So I appreciate everybody stopping by. I hope you guys have all had fun. I've had an absolute blast. And that's going to be it for me today, guys. Thank you all very much for watching. Again, a big shout out to Luna Owns and the Command & Conquer 3 Steam Group for donating the $150 worth of prizes that were distributed here today. And again, thank you to our referee, Angel of Death, who has been on hand running this event. And again, likewise to everybody out there watching and all the players playing in the event. It's made it a lot of fun. So thank you all again very much for watching, and I'll catch you all next time.